A very good morning and welcome to the 27th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We've got no apologies this morning, and Pauline McNeill is just running a little bit late and will be joining us soon. So our first item of business today is the continuation of evidence on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. And as a reminder, we are still at phase one of our scrutiny of the bill, and today's evidence will focus on part two of the bill on embedding trauma-informed practice in the justice system. We're joined today by two witnesses who have expertise in the area of trauma-informed practice. So a warm welcome to Dr. Caroline Bruce, Head of Programme with Transforming Psychological Trauma with NHS Education for Scotland, and Professor Thanos Karatias, Professor of Mental Health at Edinburgh Napier University and Clinical and Health Psychologist at the Rivers Centre for Traumatic Stress. So welcome to you both, and I refer members to papers one and two. So I intend to allow up to 45 minutes for this session. And before we get underway, as usual, I'd like to ask members to be succinct in your questions and panel members to be succinct in your responses. So if I may, I'll begin with a very general open question, and I'll perhaps come to Caroline first and then Thanos. So what do we understand by trauma-informed practice, and why is it important in the justice sector? So, Caroline.
Thank you. I work for NHS Education for Scotland, and so as an education and training organisation, we have been a key partner in the National Trauma Training Programme. As part of that, we've been working with a number of different partners in terms of the implementation of trauma-informed practices. So as part of that, we've done a lot of work around looking at the international evidence and literature around what do we actually mean by trauma-informed practice. I think it's a really good question because it can be bandied around quite a lot. But I think the National Trauma Training Programme offers basically the same definition as there is worldwide around recognising the prevalence of trauma, realising its impact, the different ways it impacts on people, responding in ways that support recovery and that adapt in order to do your job better, and resisting re-traumatisation. I think those last two ones are the ones that can take a little bit more, definition. Resisting re-traumatisation can often be interpreted in some places as meaning being a bit nicer or reducing distress, whereas I think resisting re-traumatisation is very specifically about the ways in which processes, practices and elements of any kind of process can mirror traumatic events. So we know that trauma most often happens in relationships that lack choice and control, that are disempowering, that are unsafe, and that breach trust. And so trauma-informed principles in terms of resisting re-traumatisation are about embedding those things. But on top of that, we also have that third R, which is responding in ways that support recovery and in a justice setting in ways that help people to do the job better. And the job better is supporting witnesses to effectively participate in the process. So that would be a relatively brief definition. In terms of why we need it, coming from the National Trauma Training Programme, which is kind of the broader overarching, I was about to say mothership, but overarching principles that we use there, trauma affects people in many and varied ways that can affect how they access basic life chances, like education, like dentistry, like health, anything that you can imagine. The impact of trauma can create barriers to accessing that through the potential for re-traumatisation and avoidance of those systems and services. And so one of the reasons why we need trauma-informed systems is to make sure that trauma doesn't create a barrier to accessing those universal life chances. In a justice setting, in part, it means making sure we adapt principles and practices so that people affected by trauma can access and effectively participate in processes that are involved in either the prosecution of offences that may have been committed against them, or also for the accused, who often have their own experiences of trauma, that we're taking trauma-informed approaches for them as well so they can effectively participate.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in Thanos, and then I'll maybe just ask a couple of supplementary follow-up questions. Thanos.
Thank you very much for that. I do agree with everything that has been said already. Trauma-informed practice describes a set of principles, including safety, choice, collaboration, trustworthiness, and empowerment. It has been introduced in the literature more than 20 years ago, and is a framework that is applied effectively, does everything that Caroline said already. But most importantly, I think that by understanding the impact of trauma on people's behavior, that allows us to understand when they are behaving in certain ways in certain contexts, for example, in the court or in the prison, and that's why that makes it incredibly important. Everything else has been covered by Caroline.
Thanks very much. Thanks. That's a really helpful sort of opening overview. So one of the things that I think we grapple with is within the justice system, in any legislature, there are different subsectors: courts, police, prisons. So how important is it that if we're looking at improving trauma practice, trauma-informed or trauma-responsive practice, how important is that that really does happen across the system as a whole system change, if you like, rather than in individual organisations?
Can I take this first?
Yes, Thanos.
That's an excellent question, and actually in preparation for this meeting, this is what I had in mind, because the criminal justice system comprises of different components there. So the prison, police, all these different organizations might have like a different remit. And the principles of trauma-informed care are actually quite general, which can be a positive thing as well as a negative thing. It's a positive thing from the point of view that can be interpreted in different ways depending on the needs of individual organizations. So, for example, for courts or the police, certain principles like safety, choice, or collaboration might be more important, whereas in the prison service, the principle of recovery, for example, more focus on recovery, might be more important. So I would say that we would need to look at these principles, how they apply separately in all these different parts of the criminal justice system, and sometimes the interpretation might be slightly different. Thank you.
Thank you. Caroline, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, I think from a particularly a victim and witness perspective, when we were when Nez was researching the knowledge and skills framework, we interviewed 12 victims and witnesses and looked at the literature widely, and they told us really clearly that predictability was really important. And I think there's a lovely quote from somebody who says, sometimes I don't know whether it's a policeman or a member of the Crown Office or another organisation in front of me. I just know what they're doing with me and what they're asking of me. And so there is a really key thing about everybody singing from the same hymn sheet and understanding the same things. And also that there's a sense of predictability that this person at this part of the process can tell a witness what's going to happen at that part of the process, because they know from working together with and having a joint understanding of what a trauma-informed system looks like with all of the other justice organisations. There's another point to make, which is around, there's one part of this framework that talks about leadership and leadership of systems. And there are many things that cannot be resolved without multi-different organisations working together to resolve them. It isn't about individual practices, it's about the system as a whole. And I think that's another reason for thinking about it, not individually, but as a system. But as Thanos says, individualising it where it needs to be done, where there are different things going on. So in the framework, we've resolved that by saying, what does everybody need to know? Informed and skilled levels. And then at the enhanced level, what do people who are providing advocacy and support need to know and do? What do people who are collecting evidence need to know and do separate from that? What do people who are in courts overseeing the evidence presentation need to know and do? And then what do leaders of systems need to be able to know and do? So there are similarities, there are the generic, what everybody needs to know and do, and then there are specifics in different settings.
Thanks very much. And you mentioned the framework there, and I'm sure members will have some questions about the framework during the session. So I'm just going to open it up to members now, if anybody would like to come in. John Swinney.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested just in that last comment that Dr. Bruce has made about everybody in all different elements of the system needing to know what to do. That feels to me easier said than done. And I suppose what I'm interested in is wholly supportive of the focus on trauma-informed practice, but I'm not naive about the scale of the challenge in turning it into a practical experience that individuals will face. So I wonder what our witnesses can help us with in terms of good practice as to how we might see that turned into effects. It's all very well for Parliament to legislate for this. It's then got to happen in practical reality if it's to have any particular effect. And I wonder if our witnesses could help us on that point.
It's a really helpful question, and there's many different answers I could give to that. I absolutely agree that we need to be clear about what does good look like and how do we know when we've got there. And I think as an education and training provider, NES's approach to that is to say it's not good enough to say we've delivered training. That's an output. It's not an outcome. We need to look at what the impact on the what is the impact we're trying to achieve, and are we achieving it? And that necessarily involves feedback loops back from victims and witnesses. And in the leadership section of the framework, we talk about feedback loops being a really intrinsic part. What is it that what are victims and witnesses saying about their experience? And not in a tokenistic way, but in a routinely, regularly being given the choice to be able to give feedback on their experience. But the other end of that picture is training in and of itself. As an education and training provider, this is an odd thing for me to say, but training in and of itself is nearly useless at bringing about kind of systemic change in practice. We need training, and then we need implementation supports. We need to be able to support people in other words, to be able to take what they've been trained in and implement that in practice and demonstrate it in practice and give them feedback on it. So it's not as simple as delivering training. I would say I hope with 210 pages that we've given some detail as to what it could and should look like and a bit of a roadmap to get there.
Thank you for that. I do agree 100%, but I think that training is quite important in general, but training not only to those who are working on the ground. I think we need to think of training at all different levels, at organisation level, from the people who are working directly with survivors or victims up to the leadership. Because if the leadership understands the importance of that, that can cascade all the way down a bottom-down approach.
Do I understand correctly from that point that culture in the organisation is also fundamental?
100%. The cultural changes are incredibly important, and it's not just about someone, as I said, who are doing work on the ground to understand the importance of that and trying to implement the principles of trauma-informed care. The overall culture aspiring to become a trauma-informed organization is incredibly important for everybody to be involved in this process and deliver and action these principles.
Thank you. And Dr. Bruce also said earlier on that we've got to be clear what good looks like. And I suppose my question is, does good exist anywhere today?
I think that's a very difficult question for an education and training provider. I think that's probably not my job to, I guess, respond to. I think when we were doing the research for the Knowledge and Skills Framework, we certainly, if you look through it, you'll see quotes from many victims and witnesses saying what good looked like for them and that they received it. You'll see many also saying what good didn't look like and the impact that had, but there were certainly evidence from there. There were pockets of good practice for sure.
Can I come to that as well? There is a review, a narrative review that has been published in 2021 in Ireland, and I'm happy to send the reference if that would be helpful. There are 17 studies that have been included in that review. The quality of the evidence is not that great, and unfortunately there is very little from the UK. Most of these studies are international and they come from the US. And the other really important caveat to that evidence is that most of this work has been conducted with women and young people, whereas work on men has been neglected so far. But nevertheless, I think it is quite important. There are two important findings there to mention for the purposes of this meeting. What they found is that recognizing trauma in the criminal justice system can prevent re-traumatization, and gender-responsive programs also could prevent reoffending. So just going back to your question, there is some evidence there. We know, we have just started to know what good looks like. There is not much evidence, but there is some evidence to suggest that this can deliver on the criminal justice system, trauma-informed care, can be a positive thing overall.
Thank you much. Thank you, Camille.
Fulton McGregor, then Rona Mackay.
Thanks for coming. Good morning to the panel. Yeah, I wanted to go back to something that you had said, Dr. Bruce, a wee bit earlier there, when you, something that I totally agree with, when you talked about trauma-informed practice being around and being as important for those who are accused of offences or later convicted of offences. But of course, this is something that I've been following up in previous sessions, but of course this bill is about the victims and witnesses. Do you feel or observe that there is already a difference in how trauma-informed practice is implemented within the criminal justice system between those who are accused and convicted, quite rightly so, and the victims and witnesses? And do you feel that this bill's perhaps trying to level up that playing field, for want of a better expression?
I think that's a really hard question for an education and training provider to answer. I think the role of NEDS is to provide education and training to, you know, the organisations that have invited us thus far. So it's very hard to comment on that.
The minute you started to answer that there, I realised it was probably an unfair question. If I could reframe it a wee bit then, the organisations that get you in to do a training, do they tend to focus on those who have been convicted or are in the convicted offenders sort of line, or victims and witnesses? Do you tend to, what sort of practitioners do you tend to get?
I can answer that, but it won't necessarily clarify, I think, what you're looking for, which is that we specifically have been commissioned to do work with victims and witnesses, but haven't to. And there's no implication that comes with that. Just happens to be what NEDS is doing a particular piece of round. And I'm aware that there are good colleagues elsewhere in criminal justice and in social work who are doing lots of very good training around working with offenders. And so it's very hard to answer that, because our shop window is victims witness by nature of the fact that we are the authors on this framework. So okay. It's too hard for me to answer. Apologies.
That's no problem. Professor, do you want to come in? Or is that,
it's not something that I would, but perhaps can I just say that we have certainly seen that things have been moving on significantly the last few years, and people are becoming more aware of trauma-informed practice and care across all different organisations here in Scotland. But to what level, I don't think that this has been evaluated as yet.
Thank you. Is it all right, convener, for a second question? And it's around about, I'm just wondering if either of you believe that there's any points or places within the justice system where there could be conflict between trauma-informed practice and perhaps the goals or outcomes that are desired, such as, you know, efficient running of court business, you know, ensuring the defence can effectively challenge prosecution, these sort of things. Do you feel that there is any conflict there, or do you think it's something that needs to be more integrated and embedded? Perhaps come to yourself, Professor, first.
I think that it is a challenge. I don't think it is a conflict, but I can see that it can be a challenge to apply the principles of trauma-informed care in certain aspects of this. I would say that, for example, one thing that is quite common, what we see, I'm a clinical psychologist and I'm working clinically with people who have experienced trauma. People who have experienced trauma, they find it incredibly hard to narrate or tell the stories of what happened to them. And this is what might require in certain aspects of that work. And people find it incredibly difficult. That can be misinterpreted as, you know, they might be lying or they're not telling the truth or trying to hide things, so that can be quite an issue. But I think that understanding that can perhaps allow for more appropriate questioning in terms of content and tone, so you could get the information that you need from people.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Bruce, do you want to come in on that? Or?
Yeah, I absolutely would. I think there's many things that I could say about that, but kind of going into the framework, I think backing up what Thanos has just said, we had witnesses absolutely telling us that, and a quote from one of them, she talks about, your mind gets muddled, you can't always give a black and white answer, and that's why it's difficult when you give a statement for something like this kind of offence. Coming out of abuse, I mean, I must have got attacked well over 100 times, I think 5 of which she got charged with. But they blend into one. They really need to give you time and space and not be forceful to get this done quick. The reason why I use that quote is because we might think there's a contrast between making sure that the right to a fair trial is upheld on the one hand and making sure this person gets to be able to give their evidence in such a way that allows them to tell their story. And sometimes those two things do conflict. But that was one of the things that we had to resolve within this knowledge and skills framework. I'm very clear at the outset that's why we probably needed this knowledge and skills framework specific to justice, is to be able to bring those two things together. The other part of your question was around some of the bigger systemic issues. And again, I come back to the framework in terms of the leadership section, that I come back to those trauma-informed principles about predictability, about knowing what's going to happen and when, a sense of safety, a sense of choice. And I think if at least leaders can know what is likely to be adaptable to help victims and witnesses have that sense of predictability when they're scheduling court dates, for example, that will help to the end of a wider trauma-informed system. But there are balances to be struck. Trauma-informed doesn't trump absolutely everything. It doesn't trump the right to a fair trial, nor should it. So that's the level of sophistication and nuance that there is in balancing trauma-informed with those other competing demands.
Thanks for that, and thanks for sharing that very powerful quote. And that was good to have on the record.
Okay, thank you. Rona Mackay.
The convener, good morning, panel. Dr. Bruce, I wanted to go back to something you said earlier about the whole system and all the agencies working together generically, but also individually. Can you tell me, do you think can that work? And you know, how far away are we from that happening? Is this is a long-term aspiration? Or?
Can't answer your second question from the justice system because I am an education and training provider. What I can answer it from is from the National Trauma Training Programme. So part of my job is around working with victims and witnesses, and part of it is operationally leading the National Trauma Training Programme, where we're doing exactly this. We're thinking about leadership systemically, and we have a number of education and training resources, one of which is about to be published. I'm just trying to work out what the date is. It's going to get published in the next few days, which is exactly this. And this, because I'm an author on both of them, I've aligned them both together. So the leadership table's here. And it is very much about culture, about leadership, about organisational well-being. If you bring those three together, then it's about education and training, feedback loops, participation and power sharing with people with lived experience, processes and systems. And so I do think it's possible, and I have seen it happen, but it takes top-down leadership as well as bottom-up. And there are three key things that we have found from the National Trauma Training Programme that have to be in place to a certain degree before everything else follows, and that's the culture of the organisation, the leadership buy-in, and the basic well-being of its workforce. Those three are critical before we start trying to make changes elsewhere.
Yeah, that's interesting. Just another thing I wanted to ask, in your submission you say that the definition in the Bill of Trauma-Informed Practice should be amended to include supporting recovery and minimising barriers to effective participation. I wonder if you could maybe explain what that means, minimising barriers.
I'm hoping we didn't say amended, I'm hoping we said aligned with, but if we did then apologies, because it's not for us to say kind of how that might come about. But yes, can you repeat the last part of your question?
What do you mean by minimising barriers to effective participation?
Yeah, so it comes back to something that Thanos was saying earlier about the ways that trauma... So, for example, there are multiple ways in which trauma can affect effective participation. One small but really significant one is we know that trauma affects people's memory for traumatic events and their ability to tell about them. If we interview them in certain ways, we'll get more evidence, and if we interview them in other ways, we'll get less evidence. That's a very crude, simple, you know, black and white example, and there are multiple other ones. I think resisting re-traumatisation will get us halfway there, but you can be doing an interview or a process in a very warm, empathic, non-re-traumatising way, but still not ask questions in a way that gets the best evidence that you possibly could. And there's another part to that, which I think Thanos referred to, which we referred to in the framework as well, which is the ways in which different people respond to traumatic events in terms of behaviourally, in terms of emotion regulation, in terms of their sense of self, which are all kind of highfalutin psychological terms that we tend to use. But what it means is people can come across as less credible unless our system understands the ways that trauma is impacting on people. And we've written that into the framework as well. Now, everybody will respond to traumatic events in different ways, and some people will not be, you know, affected at all, and some people will be very strongly affected, and that's what makes the subtle nuance and the complexity of this. It's not a one-size-fits-all.
I mean, Can I come to that as well?
I think this is an incredibly important point about trauma and what trauma is, because when we say trauma, we expect to see certain things, for example, certain conditions like PTSD or complex PTSD, but trauma goes beyond all these mental health conditions. And in fact, from a mental health perspective, it is depression that is most common condition that is associated with psychological trauma. And I think we should move away from this notion, if someone is traumatized, that's how they will display their distress. We need to start appreciating that traumatic responses are quite idiosyncratic. And I think there is plenty there in this framework to explain this. But there has been something else that you said in your question earlier on to Caroline about recovery. Recovery from trauma is incredibly important and is not one of the key principles of trauma-informed care formally. It's an additional one. I was very pleased to see that NES has they have mentioned that in their framework. And I do appreciate that cannot apply to all different parts of the system. However, in certain parts, like the prison service, I think it provides an opportunity for people to receive the help they need to move on from their difficulties. And I'm aware that there are programs in many of our prisons here in Scotland where people receive that, but perhaps we need to formalise that a little bit more through legislation or pay a little bit more attention to that. It is an opportunity to help people move on with their lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for mentioning the legislation part, because obviously that's the bit that we are most interested in, and how this bill is going to actually change things as well. So thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. I wonder if I can just kind of pick up on that and maybe ask a question just about, you know, the intention of the bill, as Rona Mackay is saying, is effectively to make trauma-informed practice a statutory duty. So I'm interested in your commentary on where legislation has perhaps been used previously as a way of embedding trauma-informed practice. And do you consider that setting out trauma-informed practice as a statutory obligation is important?
Do you want to go first?
Happy to.
Yeah, please.
So I think I feel like I'm saying this an awful lot today. I have to caveat with what I'm saying with, as an education and training provider, it's very hard to comment on that. I'm not naive. I did suspect that that would probably be a question. What I can comment on is, from an education and training perspective, what leads to effective implementation and what doesn't. And mandatory training doesn't necessarily lead to the most effective implementation. So however one uses a tool to make training mandatory, we wouldn't necessarily see that as being the most effective way of making change. And I refer back to my earlier comments that where we see effective change is because there's training in combination with culture, in combination with implementation supports in terms of observation and coaching and practice, in combination with feedback loops. And all of those things, however they may be brought into play, I think are really critical in bringing about changes in practice, or the training to practice to systems change.
Okay, thanks. That's really interesting. Professor, do you want to comment
on that? Yeah, absolutely. I'm actually delighted personally that we are talking about trauma-informed care in this context. And the reason for that is I had prepared some stats from my work that perhaps I can share with you in terms of how widespread trauma is. Do you want me to give you that information very quickly? So from some work that we did in 2018, we found that more than 90% of females had experienced trauma in adulthood or in childhood, and that is in a female prison service here in Scotland. And we also found that multiple traumatization in childhood and adulthood seems to be, which seems to be the norm, is associated with a seriousness of offence. And we measured seriousness of offence as number of years in prison. That was the, you know, a simple way of measuring how serious an offence is. So that tells us that the more traumatic life events someone has experienced, the more likely they are to commit a very serious offence. So that makes trauma-informed care quite important. With males, some recent work from 2022, this is down in England, we found in a prison down there, 7.7% presented with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, 17%, nearly 17% with complex PTSD. And finally, another piece of work completed in 2019 with forensic inpatients here in Scotland, we found that 80% of those had experienced childhood adversity in multiple forms, and presence of childhood adversity in this group was associated with an increased number of convictions. That possibly answers your question indirectly. It highlights how important that is for trauma-informed care to be embedded across all different parts of the system.
Thank you. Thank you. That's really helpful and an interesting overview. Okay, I've got Katie Clark and then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. I think probably my question's for Dr. Bruce. I mean, trauma-informed care is obviously an issue across the justice system, but I know Dr. Bruce has said that more of her work is associated with victims and witnesses, and you've already said that the way that the prosecution takes evidence from a witness can have a big impact on the quality of the evidence that's given. Could you maybe expand on that, but also what implications has that got in terms of cross-examination by the defence? Witness preparation isn't a major feature of our justice system. In terms of the work that you've done, have you got any comments in relation to that in when you are speaking with and working with those who do work with victims and witnesses?
It's a great question. I think I'll probably base my answer on the framework, because the framework delineates, if we were to be doing that work, and in some places we are, what would be the key elements of it. And so I think what we know, what we found when we... So this knowledge and skills framework is based on interviews with victims and witnesses, justice leaders, 16 justice leaders, and then a huge amount of international literature review. And what we found was there was some consistency around... I know this as a clinician as well, we know this as clinicians, is the way in which people are able to talk about, give a narrative around traumatic events. So, for example... questioning which involves, can you start at the beginning and take me all the way through, versus where would you like to begin? That second question is likely to get more information, because the impact of trauma on memory can, not always, but can be to scramble it, to have very clear details from some parts, very vague details from others, be in a different order, to change order over time as the memory is processed. And so all of those things mean that there are definitely evidence-based guidelines around how to get best evidence. And we've seen that, for example, implemented in the new Scottish Child Interview Model for Bairns House for interviewing children at the Joint Investigative Interview. And I've been involved in delivery of that training and have seen some of the outcomes of the research from that intimating that understanding the way that trauma affects children has changed. Interviewers tell us it's changed the way that they interview children, and they can help children, for example, stay within their what we call the window of tolerance to be able to give better evidence, as well as do it in such a way that takes the evidence from a child in the way that they can and wish to give it. So there's a lot in the framework about that. There's an entire section within the, you know, taking evidence and applies to police equally as it does to prosecutors. What was the second part of your question?
It's about cross-examination. Yeah. And so not just, if you like, the Crown or the prosecution appropriate fiscal taking evidence from a witness, but actually the cross-examination is a major issue both for the complainers and for witnesses, and what your work means in relation to how the courts deal with that.
So what I'll say is that trauma-informed is one small part of that, and actually there's an awful lot of legislation and common law out there covering what good practice looks like. And I think if we were meeting that good practice or assuming that we are meeting that good practice, then the resisting re-traumatisation and the getting evidence in a trauma-informed way, it's the same principles whether you're cross-examining or examining in chief. You understand the way that trauma can impact someone's memory, someone's responses after a traumatic event, and you ask questions in such a way that's likely to get better, more coherent evidence. Now, this is when I was talking earlier about the balance between the right to a fair trial and trauma-informed practices. This is where the subtle nuance comes into play, I think.
Is an adversarial system able to actually deliver on some of the principles that you're setting out?
So I think as an education and training provider, that's hugely difficult for me to answer. Not having had huge amounts of experience observing cross-examination, and I am very much a scientist practitioner who doesn't like to comment on anything that I don't have significant experience of, I don't think that's one that I can answer explicitly. Thank you.
Can I?
Yes, please.
Into that. Perhaps how people, the ability to give accurate evidence would be strongly determined by the level of recovery that someone is in. So, for example, there are people who they have experienced a number of things in their lives. They had treatment in the past, and they are accustomed to talk about what happened to them. I think this group of people would be, you know, in a good position to give evidence, wouldn't be very problematic for them. But there are others who they didn't have any help, they didn't have a chance to process what happened to them. And if this group of people found themselves in that setting that you just described, very adversarial or whatever you want to call it, I think they would react quite negatively, and the quality of evidence they're giving would clearly be compromised because of that.
You're saying it's not just what happens in court, it's what's happened all the way leading up to that.
Exactly. And whether people had the chance to recover, they had any help for what happened to them. And again, there is so much variation there. There are people who had some help and support, other people whose events is quite recent, they didn't have the chance to seek any help as yet. But in general, as a rule of thumb, if you had some help in the past, you had the chance to process what happened to them, you would be more able to give accurate evidence, more likely to give accurate evidence. As we said earlier on, there is no one-size-fitting-all.
Thank you.
Can I come back in just a little bit?
I think the point you raise is a really good one around one of the key trauma-informed principles is predictability. If we do have an adversarial system, what the framework says is someone needs to know what's going to happen and how it's going to happen. We've got a really strong quote from one of the witnesses who said, do you know what? The advocate sat down with me and he said, I'll be sitting there. No, the clerk sat down with me. I'll be sitting there. You won't see my face. You'll see the back of my head. But if you get distressed, just look at my head. That'll be me there. Person will be there. That person will be there. We'll go to that person. Then we'll go to that person. Because she knew what was going to happen, she was absolutely prepared for it. Contrasting with just not knowing what's going on in the room on top of everything else. So predictability is really key. Thank you.
Thank you. Sharon Dowie, then Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. It's to Dr. Bruce. In the submission, you said that you suggest the definition of trauma-informed practice in the bill should be more fully aligned with the agreed consensus definition contained in the framework. Do you think if we don't get the definition of trauma-informed right in the bill that there are risks with that?
I think what I would say is that we put a lot of work into thinking about the definition within the knowledge and skills framework. I think it's incredibly helpful that re-traumatisation is part of the definition. I think that takes us part of the way. If we were not going to implement some of the framework, particularly the bits around supporting recovery or not getting the way of recovery and supporting effective participation, then the risks to that may be that we are having people drop out of the system earlier, that we are affecting people's recovery negatively in ways that aren't necessary. And so I think there are some risks if we're not implementing all of the framework, and that the reason why they're written into the framework is partly because it was what victims and witnesses told us they needed and wanted, as well as what the wider evidence base told us kind of were the integral parts of a trauma-informed justice system. But let's bear in mind that this framework is groundbreaking, and there are advantages and disadvantages to that, that there is nothing like it anywhere else in the world, that there every bit of it is taken from pieces of evidence which do exist. So all of it is evidence-based, and you'll see that from the bibliography. But in terms of an attempt at an entirely trauma-informed justice system for victims and witnesses, it's new.
Can I quickly come to that as well? I think that it is quite important to say that there is not just one trauma-informed care or practice model. There are quite a few out there, and they describe different, slightly different sets of principles. But I was not involved in developing this framework, so I can speak more freely. I think it's a fantastic piece of work, very well thought through, considered the literature quite widely and the evidence out there, and I think, in my view, they got it right for this.
I think my concern was if it wasn't a good enough definition within the bill, then some organisations might just stick to that definition within the bill, as opposed to you've also made comments about adapting processes and practices. So that would be kind of an ongoing thing. So if they just stuck exactly to what was in the bill, it would maybe stop them continuing this progress.
I mean, I think there's a huge amount that the definition in the bill will achieve. In terms of resisting re-traumatisation is actually not a simple thing to do, and it would be a huge step forward to be resisting re-traumatisation. You know, there's an awful lot in this framework that talks about that, and it does apply across a whole range of different settings. But there are additional elements that we would like to see aligned, I think, with the given that the knowledge and skills framework is here.
Okay. What changes have followed in relation to trauma-informed practice since NHS Education Scotland published their guidance on it? What changes have you seen?
So, in terms of this knowledge and skills framework or the previous 2017 one? This one. So I think that's a hard question, given that it's been it was only published in May of this year. And also, we're not tasked with observing the changes in practice. What I can speak to is that the training that we have been involved in has been primarily in partnership with the Judicial Institute and with judges across the Judicial Institute. And so we have been working, in fact the Judicial Institute were working on this before the Knowledge and Skills Framework came out, because they were keen to be ahead of it. And I think it's very hard, because in order to be able to answer that question, I'd have to be sitting in court watching and seeing what's happening in practice. So again, it's very hard to answer that as an education and training provider.
Could I just ask you, said you're not tasked with monitoring it. Is anybody tasked with monitoring it?
I think it's incredibly early doors for this knowledge and skills framework. And whilst I wouldn't try to answer that question, what we do say in the last leadership section is that effective evaluation, it comes back to the point that Mr. Swinney made right at the beginning, which is, how do we know when we've got to good? How do we know what successful looks like? And everyone should be tasked with, for each of the organisations and across the organisations, what does good look like? And what are our feedback loops that are telling us whether we're there or not? So I don't think that can sit necessarily with any one setting or organisation. Potentially, at least that's what the framework would say, is that everybody has to be involved in that process.
Okay. And one last question. You mentioned earlier that you interviewed 12 people. You've obviously got a lot of different examples. Do you think this bill addresses the issues that were raised by the people that you interviewed?
I think...
there's a lot of practices and procedures. We've heard before there's been a lot of change in other organisations, and they've managed to do that without legislation. So I was just wondering, with the examples you got, is this bill going to address it, or could the other organisations do it through changes to
their contact.
That's almost impossible for me to answer. And partly that's because of, you know, linked to something that Thanos said earlier, there were so many and very different trauma-informed elements that everybody brought up. I think we wrote this knowledge and skills framework to align with what they told us in terms of the trauma-related bits. But bear in mind, when you're interviewing somebody about trauma-informed practices, they're also going to tell you about all sorts of other things which are not relevant for trauma-informed practices, which we didn't include in our analyses. So that's almost, it's almost impossible for me to answer. I certainly think that avoiding re-traumatisation, which is in the bill definition, would absolutely align with what many of the victims and witnesses told us they would like to see.
Okay.
Thank you. And finally, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Good morning. Apologies for being late to your session. It's kind of a follow-on from Katie Clark's line of questioning, so I'm trying to apply this to what is an adversarial court system. So what you said about preparation of witnesses and victims, that makes perfect sense, because you need a system that brings out what they have to say. And that's what you hear from victims all the time. I didn't feel I had the voice. But when it gets to court, that's what I'm interested in, trying to apply what you're saying to the committee. So you've got practitioners, prosecution, defence and the judge who shall be trauma-informed. So my first question is, would it be your expectation that everyone would treat every witness then that comes to court in the same way, because you wouldn't, the prosecutor wouldn't know if they had adverse childhood experiences, and some people won't. So is it your view that you just apply this regardless of...
Do you want me to start?
Yeah.
Sorry.
So trauma-informed practice, the universal principle of it is that it's almost like it's like a universal protective mechanism. No matter whether it's injustice or elsewhere, you absolutely assume, given the high prevalences that Thanos has talked about and elsewhere, that the people in front of you may well have experienced significant amounts of trauma and adversity in their lives, and you go from that. So there are, you know, the basic principles of trauma-informed practice: choice, control, collaboration, trust and safety. You then move up where, and if you're observing indicators that, you know, if you understand the ways that trauma affects people and you're observing different things that tell you that this person may well be affected by trauma, well, then there are additional things that you may put in place. So, for example, if you're examining or cross-examining, thinking about the ways that memory might have been affected by trauma. So, yes, it's a universal principle. And it should apply, and this is why I use the word witness all the way throughout this framework. We don't use victim, we don't use complainer, we use witness, because many people affected by trauma might be witnesses in court cases as well. It might not be the trauma from the offence that they're in the court case for. It may be earlier offences that have been committed against them.
I would also see this as principles of good practice across the board. So it would make sense to apply them, you know, across all different parts of the system and for all witnesses in the courts. I would agree with Caroline 100% on
that. So anyone who's ever appeared in court as a witness will probably find it quite traumatic anyway. I mean, what you describe, nothing is black and white, questions can be confusing. Is there a way of drawing the distinction then between the... So to me, as a layperson, there's people who've had trauma in their life. Then there's the trauma of any, well, would be a victim actually in this case, the trauma of what that person experienced, which has to come out. And then there's the court experience itself, which can be traumatic. Would you agree or not that there are different elements to be considered or not?
Can I go first? I think this is an incredibly tricky question to answer. I think that, you know, someone who comes to the court, to give the courts and the whole system has been organized in a way that the purpose is to try to elicit the truth. And the questioning, the style, everything is around that. I personally think by trying to apply the principles of trauma-informed care, it would make more humane the practices of how people, for example, are doing the questioning and how, you know, they're trying to elicit those answers. So I think it would help. I'm not quite sure whether it would resolve completely the issue for many. So, for example, many people who would go to give evidence eventually, you know, they won't find the experience unpleasant because it, by nature of what it is. But certainly trauma-informed care would make things better in that respect. It won't resolve the problem exclusively, but it will make things better, in my opinion.
I mean, you probably won't be able to answer this, but it just crossed my mind that so up until now, where we haven't had that embedded in the system, juries still have to, if it's a jury, have to make a determination of what they're seeing in court. Is there any evidence at all that you've come across that you probably wouldn't have spoken to jurors, but would you agree it's maybe quite an important thing to maybe try and establish? Ordinary people in juries are watching, and they can see from body language. I would have thought, would you really need to be trained? You could see for yourself. I just wondered if you'd considered the reaction of juries.
I'm not. I can go first if that's. I'm not aware of any evidence from the top of my head, but I would imagine some of the stories that are being described there, or some of the events or the evidence and how it's being presented, that can be difficult or traumatizing for people. But if I'm not quite sure about that. There is some preparation in the courts about what might, I mean, that can be helpful.
Thank you. Doctor, did you want to answer that?
I don't necessarily want to answer a question around juries. We do have a table in here which talks about people who make decisions, and it has been pointed out to me that in effect that that does include juries. We didn't consider them. We don't, for lots of obvious reasons. I think it is incredibly important we talk about in the framework the counterintuitive ways in which trauma can impact on victims and witnesses. And how do we ensure that in the courtroom there is an understanding that means that the impact of trauma is not misinterpreted? And that is kind of peppered throughout the framework. But ultimately it does boil down to how do we create a courtroom which is doing what it's setting out to do, which is to get the evidence in front of the decision makers most effectively for them to be able to make the most effective decision. And that is a combination of making sure that we're examining and cross-examining and we've got all the good evidence that we need, and we're doing it in such a way that keeps a witness within what we call their window of tolerance, which is keeping their brain in a place where they can actively give evidence in the best possible way. And the trauma-informed principles that are written in the framework are designed to do that, and with that in mind, they're designed to prevent the re-traumatisation, keep it a humane process, and get best evidence.
But you wouldn't, would you see a contradiction? I mean, let's talk about the fact that in the court system there are thousands and thousands of witnesses, so there's going to be a diversity there. But in the court system, as Katie Clark said, it's adversarial, but the stories of all witnesses have to be tested in court. And if they contradict themselves, or that doesn't sound like they're telling the truth, to be controversial, you would have to accept that it's part, you know, whether we like the court system or not, that there has to be a way of balancing trauma-informed training with not, I think you actually said it yourself, with not interfering with the actual natural course of justice, to make sure that any contradictions in the evidence are also picked up.
So the framework is really clear about that, that trauma-informed practice does not and should not interfere with all of those, you know, fundamental rights, for sure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I am going to have to draw a line under our session. Thank you very much to our witnesses for coming along today, and we'll have a short suspension just to allow for a changeover of panel members. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much, members. So we're now going to move on to our second panel for today, and our panel members represent the five justice agencies who will be required under the bill to have regard to trauma-informed practice. So I welcome Laura Buchan, Procurator Fiscal Policy and Engagement at Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, Sue Brooks, Interim Director for Strategy and Stakeholder Engagement with the Scottish Prison Service, Chief Superintendent Derek Frew from Police Scotland, John Watt, Chairperson of the Parole Board for Scotland, and David Fraser, Executive Director of Court Operations at the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service. So a warm welcome to you all. Thank you very much for your written submissions. And I intend to allow 90 minutes for this session. And given the size of our panel this morning, I'd request that both members and panel members keep your questions and responses as focused and succinct as possible. And I'd also request that we keep our discussion focused on the specific provisions in the bill, since that's our purpose of our scrutiny today. And I expect that the bulk of questions will focus on part two of the bill. But I appreciate that members may have questions on parts one and three. And we'll try and if I can just ask if members can perhaps keep them to the end of the session. So I'm going to, as usual, start with a general opening question, and I'm just going to work my way from my left, so Mr. Fraser, across to Ms. Buchan. My question is really just in broad terms, are you supportive of the provisions in the bill aimed at encouraging the use of trauma-informed practice? Why? And what difference to your current practice will the bill make? So, David Fraser, I'll start with you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service are very supportive. If I may, I mean, this really originated for me as part of Lady Dorian's review, and it was designed that that would be very much part of that new court, which is part of the legislation. I think it's now become wider, and I think that's a good thing. The preparations that we are making as an organisation is very much geared at changing the culture within our organisation. I think Dr. Bruce has already alluded that a lot of work has already taken place with judicial members and the work that we're doing with staff that will actually interact with witnesses who are at courts or are at evidence by commission suites have the best sort of experience they possibly can. So very supportive of it, and we are putting in place a three-staged implementation. It's designed to come from the leaders down. It ranges from being trauma-informed, trauma-skilled, and trauma-enhanced, depending on the levels of interaction you would have with witnesses. But it is our intention that about 67% of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service are frontline staff who may at some point interact with witnesses. So we've got a big programme to actually install, and I think it will be positive.
Thanks very much indeed. John Watt.
Yes, the parole board's supportive, very supportive. In parole hearings, though, our witnesses tend to be professional witnesses, psychologists, psychiatrists, social workers, prison officers, that kind of thing. Where victims come into the scheme of things is where they observe and where they submit written submissions. So in the absence of any change in any of that, we will be more alert to the position of victims who are observing in the conduct of the process. And the one question we're asking ourselves just now is where prisoners fit into the scheme of things. Does trauma-informed practice apply to prisoners also, depending on background, age, offence, a whole range of things? I may say we haven't come up with an answer yet. We're going to have to at some point, I suppose. So we are supportive. There are a number of points of detail which take us away from the court service, for example, because our proceedings are not adversarial. If anything, they're inquisitorial. But yes, we're supportive, and whatever we interact with victims, and our victims team, or rather the Parole Scotland victims team, works very closely with them. They have all had trauma-informed practice training, as have the staff generally in Parole Scotland. The members have not yet had that, but it's under preparation and we're looking at March probably for a whole day on that. So.
Thank you. Chief Superintendent.
Thanks, Convener. Likewise, Police Scotland are totally supportive of the principles of trauma-informed practice and already embedded in some of the aspects we're doing, working with Dr Bruce's team to get some training and how we're going to develop that going forward. We've already seen that, as was referenced in the first panel, with the Scottish Child Interview Model as an example of how we take that forward. But I completely agree that we need to look at the culture, leadership and our own workforce wellbeing in terms of how we deliver that. And that's something that we're going to take forward in terms of internal working group to see how we actually embed this, because it's about getting into the corporate muscle memory and that mainstreaming of it, which I think is more important. As we've said, trauma-informed is okay, but how do you take it to that next stage of being skilled and enhanced and actually making the difference to the people that we engage with? Because just with the nature of the business, the people we deal with are in crisis or experiencing trauma often when we're engaging with them. So we just need to make sure that gets embedded in our training from probationers, which we're looking at how we develop the probationary training portfolio and how then we get that embedded through repeated training and reinforcement, because doing it once in a 30-plus year police career isn't enough. It's how we get that embedded, but that comes with an investment, and we need to get the balance of getting this right for the victims and witnesses, but what does it mean practically for Police Scotland?
Thanks very much. I'm interested at your comment on wellbeing in the workforce and how important that is in terms of the delivery of good trauma-informed practice. So thank you for that. Sue Brooks.
Yes, so we are absolutely committed to trauma-informed practice. I think we're very keen to make sure that it's properly embedded, and hopefully the written submission that we gave demonstrates that, because we are starting with our senior leadership group. We obviously look after nearly 8,000 people in custody now, many of whom are men who have suffered trauma in their lives. So as well as being perpetrators, they are often also victims of crime in various different ways. And our view would be that they absolutely, if they are in a context such as parole where they are witnesses, then the same principles should apply. I think that the view that we are taking is that we need to apply trauma-informed practice at a corporate level as well as at an individual level in working with people in our care, because it ought to impact on everything we do, our senior leadership style, including the executive group, the values that we put in place. You'll have seen the kind of statement of purpose in the corporate plan about being person-centred and trauma-informed. So everything from how we design our buildings, where we invest our money, the kind of training that we offer our staff, our wellbeing supports, all of these things are impacted. And I think it is important to look at it not just in terms of interventions that are applied, but in terms of organisational style based on the best possible evidence.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think part of what you've spoken about perhaps speaks to trauma-informed environments just as well as practice, which has come up in previous sessions. So interesting to hear your comments on that. And Laura Buchan.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Much like my fellow panel members, we are absolutely supportive and committed as an organisation to embedding trauma-informed practice. The Lord Advocate and COPFS have worked with Dr Bruce and again are committed to implementing the recently launched framework. In 2022, we developed trauma-informed training for our staff, and that has now been undertaken by 2,000 employees of COPFS and 70 advocate deputes. Why is that important? Much of what we do already is based in trauma-informed approach, but we know now that in terms of the business within our High Court, which is almost 70% sexual offences, with an increase in domestic aggravators by 7% from 2021 to 2022, that the vast majority of cases that we're going to deal with in the future will deal with violence against women and children, sexual offences, domestic cases. Our staff recognise, and we know how important it is then that we identify trauma We understand what impact trauma may have on a victim and witness in a case. And then how do we respond to that trauma in terms of mitigating or minimising any potential re-traumatisation in not just a court process, because the work that we do is a whole breadth of work in relation to investigation of deaths or cases that ultimately don't come to court. So it's about embedding trauma-informed practice across all of that work. So we are absolutely committed and we will continue to work with our partner agencies. And I suppose the point of the question is it's about being a justice system, and for the justice system, a system-led approach in terms of that being across the whole system.
Yeah, thank you. And we certainly brought that into our discussion in the first panel, is the challenges of a whole system approach in terms of trauma-informed practice. So thank you for your opening comments. So I'm now just going to open it up, and I'm going to bring in John Swinney.
Thanks, Convener. I wonder if I could start with Ms Buchan just on one point in relation to part one on the Victims Commissioner, because I'm interested in the observations from COPFS about having concerns over the proposed provisions set out in sections 16 and 17 and the potential for that to have an impact on the... let me just get the point on this. It may unintentionally impact on the Lord Advocate's retained functions. And I think the committee has looked at issues about the Victims Commissioner, about what scope and what role it could actually have. And I think what we would just benefit from is hearing what the concerns of the Crown would potentially be about the role of a Victims Commissioner and how those issues might well have an impact on the statutory functions specified in Section 48.5 of the Scotland Act, which obviously protect the independence of the Lord Advocate.
Thank you, Mr Swinney. It may be best that I respond to some of these questions in writing. At the conclusion, I'll do my utmost to answer those today. So I suppose we could start by saying that COPFS, again, are supportive of the aims of the legislation to improve the experience of victims and witness and the establishment of a Victims Commissioner. We would, of course, engage and work collaboratively with a Victims Commissioner if established. In terms of clarification of the points we made, and we can follow this up in writing, we are clear that the Victims Commissioner, in terms of the bill, would not have the power to interfere with the Lord Advocate's independence in terms of prosecution decisions. And it's about the clarity, that clarity being within the bill. So we are working with our Scottish Government colleagues on that. We don't consider the bill as incompatible with the Lord Advocate's independence, but we are in discussions with our Scottish Government colleagues to ensure that clarity is there for all in terms of the Lord Advocate's independence and her role in terms of prosecutorial decisions and other areas in terms of policy and guidance.
That's very helpful. It might be that the committee would benefit from seeing some further correspondence in which would help us to formulate a view on that point, because it's just simply to make sure. I certainly don't want to see legislation emerging which is not effective for its purpose. And if we don't get the foundations of it correct, then we're better to hear that now rather than later on.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr Swinney. We will follow up those submissions, hopefully in a more eloquent and informed.
That's been grand, thank you.
But it's absolutely not that we want to avoid the Victims Commissioner. We just want clarity around what... And we hope that that will provide clarity to any Victims Commissioner in post too, in relation to recommendations and required responses.
That would be very helpful. Thank you for that. If I could move on to the issue of trauma-informed practice. And if I might say so, Mr Fraser, the way that you articulated your own personal commitment to embedding this, in a sense, answered one of Dr Bruce's the questions I put to Dr Bruce earlier on, which is, you know, where is culture in all of this? And I wonder if you could develop some of the points about the what is necessary to make sure that an organisational culture is able to accommodate and deliver a trauma-informed approach in all of its practice?
I will try. When this first came before our executive team within the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, it was potentially, right, we need to ensure that all staff have trauma-informed training, and that will tick the box, and we can move on. But that it became clear, and especially the work that's been done with collaboration and that the team that have developed this with Dr. Bruce, it is much, much deeper in terms of that. It is about getting the senior team actually embedded and being a party to actually this is how this organisation now works. So it is a change. It's a fundamental change in terms of the thinking of the senior management team and actually leading how the organisation will operate in the future through a trauma-informed lens. And it's about having that instilled at the top and then working its way down through all within the organisation, right down to the members of staff at the coalface, and having that knowledge and having the skill set. And depending where you are in the organisation, the level of knowledge and skill that you have. And it's really about getting moving to a place where when people are interacting with our organisation, the experience they're having is the best it possibly can be under the circumstances.
How long has that taken you to get from that starting point to where you are today?
I would say we were still very much at the early stages. I mean, changing a culture and an organ...
I'm going to come on to that in a second. Okay. It's how long has it taken you to get to where you are today from the recognition of the point you started off with, that this has got to be a big cultural change in the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, and we've got to own this and we've got to lead it. How long has it taken from that moment to where we are today?
I'm not sure I understand where you're coming from, Mr. Smith.
What I'm trying to get at is I'm trying to understand how long it's taking you to get from realising and accepting that the organisation's got to change to where we are today. How long has that been? Is it a year, 2 years, 3 years?
Okay. If I can talk from a personal perspective, I was the senior executive support that supported Lady Dorian in terms of the review she did into sexual offending, and that is when trauma-informed first became on my radar. I think listening and being part of that process actually convinced me at that point, and now that's a number of years back, from the time that I recognised that actually this is important and it needs to be part of what we do. And it was very much one of the recommendations that that course should be trauma-informed. I think that it's gone beyond that now. I think we've recognised that actually it's not just the specialist court that requires the trauma-informed training, it's the whole justice system, which I think is why we are here today. So it has been a number of years it's from the point of recognition that this is something that we need to where we are today.
And is that process resulting in changes to operational practice and procedure within the Courts and Tribunal Service of a tangible, practical nature?
Starting to. There is the recognition. I mean, we have always tried to ensure that the experience that witnesses and complainers that come into the court, for example, it's been recognised a long time, the last thing you want them to do is see the accused. And we do everything we possibly do to try and avoid that situation. But we are starting to look now at the things. I suppose it's about having an understanding of what trauma-informed actually means and the principles behind it that actually start to make you look at things through a slightly different lens. So you do start to look at our policies that we have within the organisation and how consistent are they in terms of a sort of trauma-informed interaction. We are looking at our buildings and how we interact with people in our buildings. We have limitations, I have to be honest. The court estate is very historic and protected in some areas, but that doesn't mean that we can look at any dimension that we can to try and improve the experience for witnesses and complainers.
Okay. And in terms of the management of that process, you know, that it doesn't sound to me that there will be an element of this which is about project planning and all that sort of stuff, but there's a deeper element of cultural and attitudinal change. So how do you manage and drive those two distinct elements of the practical project plan and the cultural and attitudinal change?
Okay, we are absolutely invested in this. We have invested in a specialist, members of staff who are in specifically in relation to the trauma-informed training and embedding the culture in the organisation. We've got an implementation officer who is additional to our complement. We've also got support. Now, they are in specifically in order to take us from where we are now to being to a point where we are a trauma-informed organisation and it's embedded in our culture. We also have got staff in. We've got the implementation team that is supporting and looking at the Lady Jordan Review implementation, in fact, this bill, in terms of how we will then implement that. So we have got dedicated resources in place already in order to make sure that the mechanics to get us to where we need to be are there. To answer the second point, a cultural change has to be driven from the top. It has to be at chief executive and executive team level. It has to be embedded and believed and lived at that level for it then to go down into our senior managers. And then down throughout the organisation. And a culture change is not something that happens overnight. And sometimes you do find, in my experience, in different things we've tried to do, is occasionally you do get a little bit of resistance, or it might be slow in some parts, and you just have to work with it and continue to work with it. And it will take time for us to actually move to a position where we are, and we can come back here and say, yes, I can say to you that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service is a truly trauma-informed organisation and it is embedded in our culture. But it is a journey that we are making.
And my last question was going to be to you on the question of resistance and whether there is, you know, I can imagine there will be 101 practical reasons why some of this is difficult. So is that what you're encountering, or are you encountering almost philosophical resistance to the type of approach that's been taken?
So let me clarify. We are not encountering any resistance at this point. I'm just making the observation that in any culture change that I've been part of or experienced, there are occasionally things that come up that you didn't expect that you have to deal with. There will be challenges, and maybe resistance is the wrong word. I mean, the challenges, one of them is the buildings that we have in terms of actually how can you truly change the physical buildings. That becomes a challenge. But you then look at, well, what else is involved, the interaction that our staff have with the people and things that we can change to make that experience better. If I may, I mean, one of the key things for me is acknowledging the limitations of the buildings evidenced by commission, where we actually managed to get the evidence at a much earlier stage in a much better environment with total separation is a much, much better solution in the longer term, I would say, and one that I think is probably up for discussion at other parts of this bill.
See, that's a very interesting observation about the fact that there are very practical procedural approaches that can be taken, and some of this may also, I was interested in Mr. Watt's point about the nature of the parole board hearings being more of an inquisitorial nature, which relates to some of the issues the committee has considered about whether trauma-informed practice, a line of questioning that my colleague Katie Clark has led, is whether this is, you know, almost trauma-informed practice is incompatible with an adversarial court system. I don't take that view because of solutions such as evidence by commission. But I think it opens up the necessity to think about what is the process of interrogation and scrutiny that goes on within the court system.
I would agree 100%. It is important that whoever we're interacting with as an organisation, we do it through this trauma-informed lens. And I think it is important that we ensure that, you know, the justice system in Scotland is a fair justice system. And I honestly believe there are improvements we can make, and what we're talking about here will make those improvements. And I don't see it as removing anything in terms of the justice process we've got. That's a personal observation.
My very last point, Kavir, if I may, is just to say that I must ask the other members of the panel, really to follow on from the last point that Mr. Fraser has made, which is that trauma-informed practice has been around for quite a while. It's been part of the thinking of the system. There's been a lot of good work undertaken on this. But it still seems to be slow to get embedded. So is there an acceptance that there has to be a level of priority attached to this to change culture and attitude and to turn legislation into practice to make sure this can be realised? Sue Brooks, perhaps.
So I think it's a really interesting question, and I would say that whilst the legislation provides kind of fresh impetus for prison service to continue to be motivated to make progress in this direction, that wasn't why we started. We've always obviously worked with people who are very traumatised and vulnerable and you know my own experience in Pullman, and so that really it's been a journey that we've been on for many years, and it's good that that's now becoming part of the kind of corporate entity. I think, I was just listening to David talking earlier about how you implement this in an organisation, and for me it's about taking the principles of trauma-informed practice, like choice and control and empowerment and safety and trust, and then applying them to how you actually implement this in an organisational setting. And that's at least in part because we're running out quite detailed training at the minute with our senior leadership group to promote changes in practice and thinking. But at any given time in those sessions, we don't know how many of our senior leaders have experienced trauma themselves. We don't know in this room how many people have their own experience of trauma. So you have to be sensitive to the way in which that is implemented. And some of the things that we need to do, we've already got changes in practice around things like the implementation of non-pain-inducing restraint, for example, is very much trauma-informed. So is a policy that we were looking at just this week on a refreshed approach to alcohol and drugs, which is recovery-based, where one of the things we're thinking about is, do we need to change the rules about disciplinary procedures to reflect changes in trauma-informed practice in order to support a recovery model? So, you know, all of our kind of policy areas are now starting to be impacted. But we also need major shifts in, for example, how we deploy our staff group, because one of the things that is critical for trauma-informed practice is to have appropriate staff supervision and support, and that means that staff have to have time when they're not directly looking after the folk in our care to be able to reflect on practice, and that's a major, major shift. So I suppose I'm just reflecting, it is very much a journey. It's about getting your senior leadership team on board. It's starting to make changes in practice, but also recognising that you need actually some quite big operational shifts that take time to embed.
So I'm just going to bring in Pauline McNeill in a moment, but I wonder if I can just come back to yourself, John Watt. So in the parole board submission, you question the sort of categorisation of the board as a criminal justice agency. I'm just interested in why that was, and how should trauma-informed practice be applied to the parole board?
I do more than question it, I challenge it. The parole board for Scotland, I think its status is fundamentally misunderstood and widely fundamentally misunderstood. It exists as a judicial body. Its only function is to make judicial decisions on release and recall of prisoners. It's not an agency, it's got no executive functions, it has no budget, no staff, no premises, no hierarchy, no management structure, no employment structure, no governance structure. None of these things. It sits in a peculiar, unique position, and all it does is make judicial decisions. I have no management authority over members of the board. The only way they can be taken to task, if you like, is for Scottish ministers to refer them to a judicial disciplinary tribunal, specially assembled for the purpose. It also sits in a bit of a vacuum. It is what I've explained it is. It's not an agency in any sense of the word. It may be a court. Well, it is a court, we know that. But it's a unique court because it's inquisitorial, not adversarial. It's a key part of the system, but in the present context, we know that victims are traumatised before we ever see them. And that's usually because a letter drops onto their doormat saying the person who murdered your husband is due up for parole soon. And by the time you get to talk to them, they're in bits. So it's really a question of fitting all these bits of the jigsaw into a system which actually works from the point of prosecution to conviction to sentence, and how it is that we can keep victims informed throughout the process so that nothing comes as a surprise. They come to us and we have to try to stabilise the position, if you like. And it's not our victim team, because Parole Scotland, which provides administrative support for the board, comes under the auspices of Scottish ministers, not the board. They are not answerable to us in any way, shape or form. It is they who have to talk to the witnesses and deal with them and undo the damage that's been inadvertently done already. At the other end of the system, if you like, is when victims, when prisoners are released, for example, and they're recalled, victims will tell us that they've been re-traumatised by the fact that they get no support in the community. They say, this man's out with all the support he can get, and I'm sitting there in my house terrified, just waiting for him to come and get me. So the board makes judicial decisions and judicial decisions only. It has to do it on the grounds of fairness, and if that means some revisiting of trauma, then that's just the way it has to be, because there's no way around that. We have to be fair to everybody. Any court appearance is going to be traumatic. You can minimise it with best will in the world. Now, I've taken evidence and I've given it, and taking it is a lot easier than giving it. It really is. And I don't quite know what you do. For my part, I'm not unconvinced that we need a complete review of the system. I mean, from the ground right up, how do we work with each other? How do we deal with victims as a system, to echo the Crown Office's position? And the answer to, I don't know the answer to that, except that we have to. There has to be some continuum for victims, as far as the board's concerned, some continuum from conviction, and no long gap of, say, 20 years, while a prisoner serves his punishment pardon. 20 years down the line, somebody who's 20 years older and frail, perhaps, gets the shock of her life. So that's what's necessary. But the board is not an agency. It's got nothing in common with the Lord Advocate, the Scottish Ministers, the Chief Constable or the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. If any part of the parole system should go in there, it would be Parole Scotland. But then that comes under the auspices of Scottish ministers, so it's probably not necessary. To finalise my argument, there's no reference to sheriffs or senators in there. Now, the parole board consists of judges for the very narrow purpose of parole, but judges nonetheless. If the parole board's in there, then sheriff court sheriffs and senators of the College of Justice should be in there also. I rest my case, Madam Convener. Thank you.
a case very well made. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill, then Russell Finlay. Pauline.
You certainly convinced me. No, actually, I thought you answered a lot of practical questions for me. This is where my line of questioning comes from. Trying to apply all this to a system which you said, John Watt, is not the same. All of you do different things and we have to apply differently. So my first question is to Laura Buchan from the Crown. Now, David Fraser said, well, we've got a court system where with limited capacity to prevent what victims always complain about, which is the trauma of bumping into the person of which you've accused. Now, can I share with you, I've had this conversation with the Lord Advocate at least once. The trauma of victims trying to find out where their cases are is a significant factor. And I support all that's been said, but I'm a bit concerned that we don't fix the things that are causing lots of trauma. And what I said earlier in the earlier panel, as a layperson, trying to understand, there's people who have had trauma in their lives before they were offended against. Then there is those who've been offended against and the trauma of that. And then there's the trauma of the system, what the system's doing to it. So that was my first question, Laura, just about, can anything be done to make the information from the Crown easier to access?
I'll try and take that question in parts, Ms McNeill. So, absolutely, we know from the work that we do and the work that our Victims of Information Advice team do and our specialist prosecutors do, that in order to get best evidence from witnesses is in relation to effective engagement and, as Dr Bruce referred to earlier, effective participation. We know the key to that is more regular engagement, meaningful engagement, and then allowing victims and witnesses to make informed decisions about how they may wish to give their evidence, and setting out, again, as was eloquently put this morning, who's in the courtroom, what does a court look like, what will the system look like. We do that in relation to our victims' information advice. We have a service that provides information to victims in certain categories of offences. We know that in order to do more of that, and we want to do more of that, including meeting victims, always meeting a prosecutor in advance of a sexual offence case. Perhaps we would like that meeting to take place more than once. That requires investment. That requires, I suppose, referring to Sue's point, we can deploy our staff in a certain way. And at the moment, we require to deploy our staff conducting courts, managing witness information and dealing with witnesses in serious, significant cases. And we know, therefore, that we have improvements to make more widely. We are looking at that. There's a victim and information, there's a VM modernisation programme where we're looking to improve the information, the way that we communicate. That's in relation to children specifically. We're looking at the way that we write to children and provide information to them. So that work is underway. There's also the Lord Advocate instructed the Sexual Offences Review, which is almost near completion, and we will be awaiting the report and recommendations from that review. And there's significant investment from the Scottish Government in terms of our IT solutions, and we're looking at a witness gateway where victims and witnesses will have more ready access to the information. As you quite rightly raise, it is often really frustrating for witnesses, which would appear to be straightforward in terms of what's happening with my case, when will my case call, how long might I be in court. So there are lots of things that we are looking to do already to improve the service that we offer to victims and witnesses, and would hope in the embedding of the legislation and trauma-informed practice across the system that will continue to improve.
So you said gateway. I wonder what that means. I mean, in simple terms, if you're a victim of crime or even the witness that you've been called, shouldn't you just be able to phone someone easily, get through and say, well, where is my case in the pipeline or where is it likely to be? Is that fair?
Fair. You should be able to do that. And if you are a victim or witness who falls into the category of victim information advice, there's a more proactive service in terms of what information will be provided. But that does not prevent anybody who is a victim or a witness in a case from simply phoning COPFS.
But that's the problem. That is the problem. Ask anyone. Ask anyone how easy it is to get through. And it's not. It's not as the problem.
And anyway, I have responsibility in my role as policy and engagement for our National Inquiry Point team too. Mm-hmm. So that's something that we can certainly take away. And I appreciate that you've raised it with the Lord Advocate.
Yeah, well,
we understand that the frustrations, the improvements that we require to make.
Thank you. My second question is about... So what we're hearing is from the previous panel of experts that dealing with trauma-informed practices is kind of a universal application. So I'm trying to think about that for prosecutors in court, prosecutor fiscals. Is it really practical to treat every single victim or witness as if they had a trauma? Or what trauma are we looking at? Is it the trauma of being in court, or is it? And how do you see that? How will you train your procurators then, prosecutor fiscals and advisor ADs in relation to court practices? I mean, I know you can't answer this today, but I think it's what I'd like an answer to in the long run. How are we going to balance this? with fair justice to ask robust questions in court of all witnesses?
And absolutely. I mean, I think the important point is it's not about treating every victim and witness in the same way. It's about having the skill set to identify trauma and what that, how that might have impacted. So it is actually more difficult because trauma affects and impacts different people in different ways at different times. I think quite properly, and I think if we set out our submissions as prosecutors, we work within the rules of evidence, we work within the prosecutorial legal system that enshrines the right to a fair trial. As part of that, as proving the case, we require to take evidence. Defence require to cross-examine a witness. They're entitled to do that. And inevitably, taking of evidence and re-examination will often lead to people having to recount trauma. So that does sit within the adversarial system. But as that goes, there are already many things that we're doing. David Fraser spoke about evidence and commission, about really trying. The starting point is to mitigate against people having to come to court at all. So we can talk about early resolution of cases to prevent that ever happening, evidence of commission, special measures. There are already rules of evidence which should protect complainers in relation to the line of questioning in terms of inappropriate questioning. And again, this bill should go, we would hope, some way to enhancing those powers and enhancing complainers in those situations. We agree there's probably a better understanding required for courtroom advocacy. But again, we would hope in relation to the trauma-informed training that we've already rolled out across, you know, a huge amount of staff within our organisation, including High Court prosecutors, that we are embedding that further. Mm-hmm. We can't sit in our still in that. We need to continue to refresh that training, and we need to ensure that we are really ensuring that our core values, which are being professional and showing respect, are reflected in everybody that sits within COPFS.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay, then Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. I only intend to ask one question, but I feel it's important to provide some details about a specific case in relation to trauma-informed practice. I've been working with Leslie Jones, who's...
Can I just stop you there? Is this a live case or is
no.
it? No. Okay.
I've been working...
Can you make sure that this is relevant to the provisions
Absolutely.
Of the bill?
Yes. I've been working with Leslie Jones, whose brother Tony was murdered, and when she attended the killer's parole hearing, she was told to sit in silence. She objected to his release in writing, fearing for the safety of others. He was subsequently released. She was required to sign a gagging order not to discuss the hearing. Her brother's killer was then recalled to prison, but Leslie was not told this, nor allowed to know why. She only found out because he has another parole hearing, and she's consumed by concern, not knowing if he's harmed somebody else. She's had letters calling her brother Anthony, that's not his name. She's had letters addressed to her dead father. She describes the parole process as secretive, and she said that she's, and I'm quoting, climbing the walls, the process is tormenting me. Now, Leslie's experiences are quite shocking, but actually all too typical in some respects, and seriously call into question the issue of trauma-informed practice. And I suppose my question is, are you confident that this bill will result in victims and their families being treated with dignity, compassion and respect? Or perhaps, as John Watts already suggested, a ground-up review of practices across the criminal justice agencies would be a better starting point. Thank you. Probably, John, I think, but...
I would have to differ with you on one point. That's an atypical case. It's not typical at all. I mean, if you read the Daily Record, so last week or a week before, there was a very positive article about how the victim's team works. But that's a unique case. It's a very difficult one. I responded to you in writing, if I remember rightly. So you've got the answers to most of these questions already, I think. And I'm not going to sort of go back over it again. Can I be confident that this bill will change any of that? The answer to that is no, because we have limited control over how matters work around the parole board, if you like. Because some of the issues you raised weren't directly raised at the parole board, I don't think, because part of the problem, if I remember rightly, arose from a series of adjournments, did it not? Or deferrals?
Well, in response to the first point, after myself and another MSP, an SNP MSP, I wrote to various agencies on behalf of Leslie, the parole board sought a meeting with her and asked why that she'd not made representation to them first, and her response to that was that she had, and in respect to this being maybe atypical, it may be extreme in its longevity and complexity, but I don't think it's that unusual in some respects.
I'm not sure I can answer that question here and now because it relates to a specific case. And I'd have to go back, I can't remember the details now. I would have to go back and look at that specific case. And to describe the form which she signed as a gagging order is, I have to say, a bit extreme. It's not a gagging order. It's simply a reflection of the legal position in relation to disclosure of information in terms of the rules. She can't disclose information unless the chair of the hearing allows it. And that's basically what that form says. Understand this, because if you go out and do it, there could be consequences for you. Now, the other thing I'd like to say is...
Can I just interject? Is that slightly at odds with the principle of open justice and transparency?
Hey, those are the rules, Mr. Finlay. I didn't make the rules. Parliament made the rules. I apply them.
Can I perhaps just bring this back to the provisions of the bill, if there's anything further you'd like to add?
I'd like to ask if Mr. Finlay wants to write to me requesting more detail, very happy to provide it for him.
The only reason I went into detail was because it was required in order to illustrate how difficult it is for many victims and families. But the more general point was whether the legislation, the bill as drafted, will actually materially, practically fix a lot of these problems. And I think families like this one have their doubts.
Well, I can understand that, and I accept that, and it may well be that some aspects of the rules will have to be revisited. But if you do that, then it can lead to further unintended consequences, which is why my personal view is that we need to look at the linkages between the various bodies involved in the process, which leads up to a parole hearing, and potentially after that. And ground up, yes, I would go for that. I think we really need to start talking to each other a bit more effectively and to look at the powers the board has and the duties imposed on it by Parliament. And if Parliament wishes to change those, then I will do my level best to do what Parliament wants me to do.
And I don't know if anyone else has got a view on that. Yeah, thank you.
Certainly from a local policing context and working within a community planning partnership structure, when you've got community justice partners and your criminal justice managers that work in that context, I don't think what I have read in the bill, and I'm not an expert on the draft bill by any manner of means, I don't think that will solve that systematic issue. I've seen it myself, I won't go into any specifics, but when there's people getting out, the trauma that has in the family and that miscommunication and that joined upness probably isn't there, and the support mechanism for the victims probably isn't there. So my experience is that disconnect will not be fixed by what's in the bill, would be my observation.
Much, and if anyone else has got a view on this, it's a general question, but no, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Swinney, do you want to come in?
If you just allow me to just ask one question of Chief Superintendent Frew, in light of what's just been said there, I was struck by how you articulated that point, that the question of somebody being released through the parole system. However much you engage with people, that is going to be a traumatic event. It's fairly, and a lot of what we're talking about is about trying to reduce the effect of that trauma. Is that a fair representation of the point that you've just made?
Yes, I think it's a fair representation. And there's that element of individuals who are that victims or witness, but or are a complainer, they may not be able to rationalise the outcome of the parole board hearing ever. And regardless how much support that they'll get will create an issue for them in that revisiting that trauma, but it's about what support there is in terms of services, whether it's victim support, rape crisis, or whatever the necessary bodies that wrap around it. What is that, probably third sector on many occasions, what is that support mechanism that's in place? It's probably a bit of a gap.
But that's helpful.
Followed by Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I'm not sure if this would be for David or Laura. Just for context, can you give us an idea of how much, you talk about evidence by commission, how much of that has been done percentage-wise at the moment?
I can follow that up. We do have the figures. I don't have them with me just now, Ms. Mackay, but I can certainly send them to the committee in terms of the amount of evidence a commission that's currently ongoing.
Or sure. Here today, I mean, since we started, I think the first year we did about 74. Subsequently, it's almost doubled year upon year. Last year's figures from memory, and again, you know, I can give you the exact figures, but it was about 600 that we dealt with. And again, this year we're on track to more or less do slightly more than that. So it is a significant number.
It's going to grow. Yeah.
It's certainly it's a growth since we introduced it after the bill that allowed us to do that.
Okay, thank you. That's useful to know. The other point to make to Laura, my colleague Philip McGregor and I were in the Justice Committee in the last session. One of the first things we did in 2016 was an inquiry into the Crown Office. And at that time, going back to my colleague Polly McNeill's line of questioning, the key point that came out of it was communication, lack of communication to victims and witnesses. And it seems to me that was a long time ago and it's not improved that much. So from what you're saying, you know, you're now addressing this and taking it very seriously. Is that going to happen sooner than 8 years? Because it was a key thing that came out, that just people being left in the dark, and that caused great trauma.
No, and I can understand that. I suppose I would disagree with you that there's been no improvement in that. I think we recognise that as any organisation, is that we're always looking to improve. And I think the Lord Advocate in particular will speak about how the importance of effective engagement, about compassion, about listening. So I understand your point. I think we have made significant improvements in the way that we communicate and work with victims and witnesses than we have done previously in terms of the time of your review. And hopefully some of the work that I've outlined today in relation to Ms McNeill will support what we are doing in terms of ongoing. In relation to solemn cases, in all solemn cases now, we have victim strategies in relation to contact and engagement with victims. In relation to victims where there are children and vulnerable witnesses, we have plans in place in relation to engagement with those victims. Well, we're previously, there were not the same things there. So we know that that's a frustration. I suppose what I can note, though, as I indicated earlier, the type of business that we deal with now has changed, and it has changed since you carried out that review, where we are dealing with significant serious sexual offences, and that makes up a large part of our business, and that involves more effective communication, more meaningful engagement.
I take your point. As a committee, we will be able to judge that, because we do speak to victims and victims' organisations who at the minute are not telling us that a lot's improved. So we will obviously be able to monitor how effective all that's being. Can I ask Chief Superintendent Frew, in your submission, you say that the training required for trauma-informed practice would require significant investment, and it raises significant concerns. Now, you've said, and everyone has said, that you're well down the road of all doing that. So why would it require significant investment? I'm not just to give me an idea of why that was raised.
Yeah, I hope I didn't give the impression that Police Scotland is well down the road. We're on the journey, but I wouldn't say we were well down the road. And I can give an example of 2018, I personally was part of the first division within Police Scotland that had been trauma-informed. It was in Ayrshire, for those that remember Paul Main, who was the commander at that time. And that was an investment of face-to-face training, resilience video, getting trauma-informed training. It was really impactful training. That is 5 years ago. The opportunity cost to do that and the ability to abstract that, to maintain that level just to get to trauma-informed. At that point, it didn't go across Scotland because of that. The ability to do that was really challenging. So we go to where we are just now in the landscape that we're operating in with the legislative changes that are coming from different aspects to the resource challenges we've got, and to actually take this forward and do that trauma-informed to trauma-skilled to trauma-enhanced. We're probably going to have to take a tiered view on that and work out how we can deliver it. So it's going to be a Moodle package of some description going forward, working with Dr. Bruce's team. There are two packages there, and Dr. Bruce will hopefully keep me right after this committee if I'm wrong, but there's two there that's available for public sector organisations that you can get that take you to trauma-informed. To then take us to trauma-skilled, which is where you really want to be to make that impactful change, we're going to have to develop further training packages. That training package, again, is the resource development of that. How we then get that onto our Moodle system, which normally sounds simple for me to say that, but we really want it linked onto a system in Police Scotland where it's accredited. We get an auditable position of the number of officers that have completed that so that they're skilled, so that from an evidence base, I could come back to a committee in however many months' time and say, we have got X amount of operational officers and these are the ones that have completed the training. To actually embed that and develop that training and put it in place is expensive. In terms of to get to trauma enhanced, there's clearly going to be certain roles that we need bespoke training for because we need to take it to that next level. Now, whether that's sexual offence liaison officers, family liaison officers, senior investigating officers, there'll be a whole list of people that are working with the most vulnerable victims and witnesses. So we have to develop that bespoke work. Started in doing that, but we don't have a finished product. But it's the time, the cost, and what those packages look like within the myriad of other demands. And that demand, and it's a well-rehearsed position where Police Scotland feel we are with our budget and where we will be going into the next financial year. And it just seems to be getting tighter on us all the time. So it's not to say woe is us and we're not doing it, we're committed to doing it. But that cultural leadership and actually embedding it, I'm just giving you an example of my personal experience, my journey for 2018, 5 years, and we're still on that journey. So that's the challenge I see.
That. And just briefly, Laura, your submission said a similar thing, but you sound like you are well down the road to trauma-informed practice, so why would it need lots of more investment?
Exactly the same situation as in terms of training and the input and the culture, we're working towards that, we're on a journey, but in terms of the spectrum of what that might look like, in terms of more regular, we spoke about more regular engagement with victims and witnesses, that requires investment, refreshment training, development of other training, changes that are policy and guidance. These are all things that require additional resource and that can't simply be absorbed by the budget that we already have. So we can make small changes, we can continue to develop the training, we can continue to train our staff, but in terms of significant big changes, particularly around that engagement with victims and witnesses, that's not something that we can currently absorb at this time.
But I'm just going back to points made earlier that culture change comes from leadership. I'm not understanding why that would be expensive.
No, and that's not the expensive part. We've already undertaken that training. Mm-hmm. We've undertaken the leadership training. That's not the part that would require resource. It's about the much bigger issue in relation to the caseload that we have in terms of individual contact with victims and witnesses that require resource. I think we do have in our submissions the cost of a one-day training for all our staff. But that's the only really quantifiable expense and cost mm-hmm. we can put on those submissions at that time.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Kavira.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I wonder if I can maybe just staying on the theme of resource implications, I can maybe bring in some of the other panel members just to, for any comments that you wish to make on that. Maybe David Fraser to start.
the memorandum, we have identified costs in terms of that. Part of those costs are for the development of the actual training to be delivered, and then an ongoing annual cost to train new staff as attrition happens and we get new staff in. So there is an element built into that. I think I said earlier as well, I mean, the training that we intend to doing is quite... is much of a larger scale than we would do normally. And for example, in leaders training, it's up to about 5 different separate sessions to actually get this full understanding. It's not a simple day's training that is spread about all the whole organisation. It is very much targeted. The costs are in relation to us being able to do that in terms of the one way we could do it is close the courts for a day. And or 6 days in terms of which you're sorry, the costs are for a single day, not for the 6 days that we're actually doing. So I suppose you could say that we're absorbing a number of the costs, but it is involved in terms of getting the 67% of the organisation, as I said, who are frontline away from doing their day job and actually getting this knowledge transfer and getting to the level of skill that we need them to be at.
Thank you. John Watt, is there anything you would to maybe comment on?
I have no specific figures, but any new... Well, it's not a new area of work. It's an area of work which we're looking at more closely now. Will bring with it a cost. But there will be other costs. So, for example, one of the things that the whole system should avoid is churn, because if a victim is teed up to come along and give evidence or to view a hearing, it's a demoralising and traumatising experience if it goes off. So then we're looking at trying to improve the quality of the material that we get, improving the quality of dossier, and there's training involved in that, sometimes out with the Parole Board or Parole Scotland. Equally, granting deferrals, there's a whole area of training I'm going to have to look at in how members look at that. Now, I can't tell them what to do, but I can advise, I can persuade, I can train, I can't direct. But so you don't just look at this trauma-informed practice in isolation. There are a whole range of other things which, if you don't get them right, will create a set of circumstances where you end up with trauma that you could have avoided further down the line if you'd put the effort in and got your quality control in at the start of the process rather than at the end. So it's not simply parole board training, it will be other aspects and other parts of the system as well.
Chief, I don't know if there's anything else that you want to add in, Chief Superintendent.
I think our vision and our aspiration is to get all frontline officers at trauma skilled level. And that's where the investment comes in, because that's where there'll be the opportunity cost, there'll be the development of the IT, which I would be an indicative figure I would give you today, which probably would be meaningless, but it's probably going to be in the low millions in terms of opportunity cost and IT development. But where we are with a restricted budget just now, anything that even the word thousand get mentioned is a lot these days, but I know it will be in the millions to actually deliver it in terms of cost.
Thank you. Sue Brooks.
So I think there's a number of kind of dimensions to the resource issue, I think. And as I explained earlier, we're starting with our leadership cohort across prisons, which is a relatively small group. Even that, though, at the minute is causing difficulties because we're very limited in our own internal forensic psychology resource. But we're working in partnership with the health boards and the clinical psychologists across that are associated with prisons to try and support that that rollout. So I think there are things that we can do, both to use our own existing resources more wisely, but also to work in partnership to across different agencies to try and make that happen. I think in terms of the wider issue about training rollout to our staff group, in a way, the idea that you could throw lots of money at that and it would all happen much more quickly is probably not necessarily a wise way to go. We started in our journey by engaging with a number of experts in Scottish Government and also in NES. And their advice very clearly was to take this slowly and gradually and work carefully with the staff group. And that certainly I think in prisons down south, they have rolled out quite a lot of training, and there are some research reports around that which suggest it's not very successful and can actually be quite damaging if you don't have the right infrastructure in place. And that's particularly around things like staff supervision and the criticality of that. So we've been advised to start with the kind of basic information level for our staff group, which is why we're putting e-learning packages from NES on our e-learning system, and probably also why we will target specific members of staff and establishment in key roles who can then act as a kind of a coach or facilitator for a broader staff group. So at the same time as we've got the leadership group really engaging in problem solving and kind of system change across the organisation, you're starting to get that kind of bubbling up of general awareness without putting your staff at this stage anyway in a position where they're being asked to engage in trauma-informed practice without the right supports in place. Now, as I explained earlier, there are opportunities. The government is also asking us to reduce the working week and look at our staff deployment structures, and so if we make really significant changes around that, we can move our resources around to be able to deploy that more wisely and achieve hopefully those kinds of objectives, as well as being able to reallocate resources to do this kind of thing. And my last point, and apologies for going on, but I think in many respects we are in quite a unique position as system leaders, because we are at the tail end of a process where people who have been very severely traumatised in childhood end up with us and inflicting damage on others. And there's been some talk about the kind of evidence and research base, but I think it's really, really important that as we go through our individual and system organisational journeys, that we get the right kind of research and evaluation to be able to reflect back in a preventive sense. How would we have prevented people getting into this position in the first place? And I hear people talking about domestic abuse, sexual offending. We have 8,000 men in custody. There's a real issue for me about what that experience has been in childhood for boys, particularly in houses where there is domestic or sexual abuse, and what our experience of dealing with trauma is telling us about what we need to do up front to reduce system costs, both in personal terms and also in resourcing terms. So I just suggest that.
No, that thank you. That's really comprehensive. I don't know if Laura, you want to add anything in at all. I'm thinking my question was more about broad resource implications. Obviously, training is one of those, but if there are other areas where you see there being in particular a resource implication, I'm sure there will be.
I think nothing further than I've previously added in relation to that engagement with victims and witnesses, and I suppose the points that David makes in relation to how we then deploy our staff to that training and how regularly that training takes place.
Thank you. Okay, a couple more members looking to come in. So Fulton McGregor, then Sharon Derry.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I've enjoyed your evidence so far. I think as committee closes in on this parts 1 to 3 of the bill, it does feel like we remain a wee bit unclear on what the need for part 2 is or what it will do. And I have to say, I do say that with some surprise for myself, because even in my own experience as a justice social worker, trauma-informed practice has been around for a long time, I think, as everybody has referred to. And I think what I'm gathering, I'm not speaking for anybody else here, is that it's not the principle or the understanding of it that I think we are grappling with, but rather the different evidence that we're getting from organisations, including the 5 today, about where organisations are with it. And what it feels like is that there's good examples across the board, but places where things could improve. And I think one of the things I want to go back to, Chief Indignant, I think that when you spoke earlier about the interviews of children, and you know, including that would be the joint investigative interviews, I think they are a very clear and robust good example of trauma-informed practice. And so what I wanted to ask you firstly before I widen it out was, that is something that's well established. I mean, that's joint investigative interviews have been on for, you know, well over 20 years now. Is that an area where the police are looking at taking the practice there to other areas? And could I just be a devil's advocate and ask, why, you know, why don't we do a similar model with almost all interviews?
So the joint investigative interview model has been there for a while. The new Scottish child investigating model takes that a step further. Multi-agency, as you'll be aware, with social workers and really looking at the whole trauma around about that child to make sure that everything's done really properly. We're actually not fully rolled out across Scotland yet. Understanding is it's probably June 2024 before the SCIM model, as it's known, is going to be fully in place. So I hope I'm quoting that date correct. But you're right, that's one element. There's the relationship we've got as corporate parenting, working with children's homes, the not-at-home policy, so that we're not there, those children that are in those homes treat it like a home and they're not reported missing just because they've just not returned at 4 o'clock, but they might be going to come in at 6 o'clock that night. So that real compassionate understanding, working with partners. In terms of the wider how we do it to investigations, there's an investigation strategy put in for most significant and serious investigations, particularly where there's going to be significant trauma, and how we deal with witnesses, where it's going to be, the preparation, the notification, what support they're going to get is all part of that strategy that we put in place. So I would like to think that although we're saying, I didn't say we're that far down the line, I think when we actually take a step back, certainly for Police Scotland, and we look at what we do is... And I don't mean to be too twee to go back to our values of fairness, integrity, respect, human rights. That actually, in practicality now, is taking us on that trauma-informed journey with the trauma-informed information we've had. And that is the lens we put through everything that we do. So I would like to think that we're probably agreeing with you that we're going down that journey and it does get applied to a whole lot more, even if we've not given it that label or managed to crystallise that description.
Done in moving it out to the rest of the panel, I won't ask for, I won't give specific examples of practice you've maybe mentioned today, but not everybody needs to answer in the interest of time. But based on the question there I've just asked, is there anything that you're doing just now which is a really good example of trauma-informed practice, and are you considering using that to widen out to areas where you've all said that you maybe need to improve on? I see David's hand up.
I think that's a good example, and you're absolutely right. There are certain areas within the justice system that I'd say that we are more trauma-informed in terms of how we deal with people than in others, but I would say it's scratching around the edges. I mean, another example, and I've touched on that earlier, is the evidence by commission. And I think I said about 608 cases last year, that was evidence by commissions, not potentially a number of witnesses that we dealt with, because there might be multiple witnesses within a single evidence by commission. So I would use that as an example. I would also say, I mean, we've got a strategy for that expansion. We've got 4 bespoke sites already. We've got plans to expand that in Dundee, with plans for beyond that, depending on how much and how quickly we can actually expand that environment. So I'd offer that as another example. But I would say it is dealing with a very small proportion. If you look at what comes through the criminal justice system, and there is a need for everyone else who doesn't actually go through that to be treated in a way that allows them to get their best evidence out.
Laura, thank you.
Yeah, I agree in relation to the evidence by commission, and there is still a significant amount of work required in relation to evidence by commission in terms of preparation. There's also work that we're doing in relation to summary case management pilots, and that's where prosecutors are engaging directly with victims of domestic abuse at a very early stage. And again, with Police Scotland and SCTS, we're trying to front-load disclosure to ensure early resolution to, again, prevent witnesses and victims ever having to come to court. So that's something the pilot's already running. We're looking to expand that pilot.
Sorry. Just to add another point, I think it's probably a relevant point, is we're probably in a unique situation here because we're all working around the same framework. And one of the things that we recognised in terms of we're looking at domestic abuse courts and GH&I, And actually, we recognised that those involved in designing and actually drawing that forward needed to be informed so that what they were designing as we go forward actually is looked through a trauma-informed lens. So I would suggest that we are, and that involved not just Scottish Court Service, but actually everyone involved that would be in that design process, so that at the very start of the process, we're actually looking at through that lens, as opposed to traditionally where people like myself from different organisations say, well, this is what you need. And actually removing ourselves from that and saying, well, actually looking through the trauma-informed lens, what should the end product look like? So my apologies in terms of...
Yep, thanks.
John Swinney, you want to come in very quickly?
Just one brief follow-up point to what Mr McGregor has been raising. I think it's possibly for Laura Buchan. Have we exhausted, and maybe Mr Fraser as well, have we exhausted all opportunities for reforms in the style of evidence by commission? As alternatives to, let me call it, existing practice. Have we exhausted all opportunities, or is there more that could be done in the style of evidence by commission that would be consistent with delivering the aspirations of trauma-informed practice?
I think evidence by commission is, you know, has come on and is really significant. There is work ongoing specifically in relation to children, in relation to Bairns House, which takes that concept even further in terms of the hope of evidence being given in terms of the SCIM or the GII, that could be used and recorded and used in place of evidence by commission. So I suppose that's the only thing that can come to mind at this time, Mr Swinney, and if I think of anything else about how much further we can go. I suppose from a Crown perspective, yes, there's evidence by commission, but the important point is a victim being properly informed about what all the different means of way that they can give evidence, and they have a choice as to which means of giving evidence they feel will support them, again, through that trauma-informed lens. We have heard from some victims who have said, I would have wanted to have given evidence in court. So we have to ensure that there's the ability for them to have that choice. So I think evidence by commission has done a significant amount of taking children and victims out of a court process. And there's certainly more that we can look to do and look to work on to expand.
And is that part of the thinking of the Crown in trying to work out what the Crown contributes towards delivering trauma-informed practice? We must be constantly looking for ways in which we can adapt or reform the whole process of preparing for prosecution to try to minimise that effect.
I suppose it's taking our role and ensuring that we are conducting ourselves in the professional manner in which we need to do in acting in the public interest, but meantime having that consideration and engagement with the victims and witnesses. Sometimes they don't always align, I suppose the important part is having the engagement and discussion and knowing what the victim's views are before taking any decisions.
Thank you.
I've still got a number of members looking to come in, and we've got about 15 minutes left, so if I can ask for succinct questions and answers. So Sharon Dowie, followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you. I think a lot of my points have actually already been covered now, but I was looking more at the kind of financial side. Is there a risk if you don't get the finances to implement the bill, that there's a risk that you won't be able to implement it properly? I can ask that to Laura Buchan first.
I think I'd probably simply repeat what I've said earlier, Ms. Sarian, that we are committed to trauma-informed practice. We will continue to roll out the training and do the work that we want to and do in terms of compassion, choice, you know, all those parts. In terms of more widely, to enable us to do more of what we do in terms of witness engagement, victims with visits to courts, more time for victims and witnesses would require investment and more resource that can't be absorbed. So we're committed to it. How far we can go with this is dependent on resource.
So timescales and managing to implement it, if you were given the correct resources, would you be able to do some of the work just now rather than having to wait for legislation?
I think we've already, so we're already on a journey with the work and we've already begun it without the resource. So I think we will continue to do that work. How far we can go with it in terms of expansion will be dependent upon what resource was provided.
I'll give you one specific example just for the Crown Office. The Crown Office's Victim Information Advice Service for victims still does not always inform them of the outcomes of their case in some instances, which leaves them feeling as if the justice system's let them down. An example, it was found in an analysis of the victim's right to review scheme that some victims who wished to review prosecution decisions were not told of their case outcomes in time to ask for a review. So is that not just a case of changing your processes just now? That doesn't seem to me as if that would cost any money to go and implement that. So are there some things just now, if you listen to the victims' organisations, that we could implement straight away?
Absolutely. As I say, the Lord Advocate chairs the Victim Task Force. We have regular meetings with our third sector and really good positive relationships with those groups. I think that perhaps is from the Inspectorate report, and that already is part of our Via Modernisation project, is one of the programme strands in relation to ensuring that those decisions are provided to victims and witnesses when VRR may be appropriate. So there is already work ongoing, and absolutely that doesn't require additional resource. That is work that we should be doing already.
So what's the barriers to implementing something like that just now?
I'll try and be succinct. It's about identifying those cases within the vast amount of caseload that we have, identifying the cases that may be subject to victim right to review, and ensuring that contact is made. Because currently the resource we have relates to only certain categories of victims, which will be given proactive information, if that assists. So VIA does not cover all victims and witnesses. We are all only funded for the sections of victims and witnesses that currently sit within VIA. So the issue is identifying other victims and witnesses who may not sit within that criteria, who have a case that may also want to have a victim's right to review. So we're looking about how we can improve that and looking at system changes which will allow us to identify that.
And just one last question. Listening to the opening remarks, I think everybody's supportive of change. The comments were very supportive, totally supportive, absolutely committed. One of the comments that came from John Watt, he's mentioned about a complete review of the system, which I think I would be totally in favour of. I agreed with your comments. You also said about keeping victims informed so nothing comes as a surprise, which is one of the main things that seem to cause trauma. So again, to me, it seems more like processes and procedures, maybe rather than legislation. But do you think bringing in the legislation will hinder a review of the system, or will it help it?
It shouldn't hinder it. Shouldn't hinder it at all. It's not. I say it's not complicated, but it's amazing how reviews can take on arms and legs and end up like three or four octopuses in one place. Everyone's got a complication they want to bring into it. If we can keep it tight, view it through the lens of trauma-informed practice primarily, and ensuring that everybody who needs to know knows in good time, and that we can reduce the amount of human error, which is inevitable. So, for example, I was listening to some of those comments about people not getting informed. And I think if you have a tight budget and running on a minimum level of staff, that's going to happen. If you don't want that to happen, then you add a few more bodies and you're going to reduce the human error. Introduce to that an effective IT system, something that will work for you, something like Shell or BP or ICI have, which will do things for you, which will produce programmes, will throw up information, will prompt people to do things, may even do it themselves. I don't want to be unduly critical of government IT, but I'm about to be critical of government IT. It's been cut back, and the support's not there. I mean, I get breakdowns all the time, and I phone the help desk, and I get a call back 3 or 4 days later. Now, in that time, a victim might not have been informed of something. So, let's look at the information systems that we have and the people that we have. Eliminate the waste. I mean, I can give you loads of examples. This is my hobby horse. If, for example, parole dossiers were better in the first place, you wouldn't have all the additional work to do. You'd have a predictable flow of work, predictably inform victims, and have a predictable time when it's going to be heard, and it will be heard at the first time of asking, much more often than it is just now. If you can't get that kind of quality, then you're going to end up with a disjointed system in the sense that you're constantly asking for information, then it's coming back in, then you're asking for more, and it's not quite what you wanted. So it's getting the quality right in the first place. Now, you can spend a bit of money at the start of the process to save it at the end of the process, but I get an impression that that's not an argument that finds much favour just at the moment. If you said, for example, we'd like to invest £50,000 getting it ready at the start to save £100,000 at the end, it's a bit like the British Leyland Parts Department. Now, Mr. Swinney might remember that, but nobody else here will. When you went there, they said... they would say...
Deirdre to me, that.
They would say, the answer's no now, what's the question? That's what they said. So, I mean, it's really complex, but you have to get all the bits on track so that they act with each other, and you don't have the bumps, the delays, the lumps in the road that cause problems of the sort Mr. Finlay spoke of.
I would agree with your comments. Get it right at the beginning so that you get the result at the end. So thank you.
OK, I'm going to bring in Katie Clark, and then we'll have to look to just wind things up, if you can be as brief and succinct in questions and answers as possible.
I will try and be as brief as possible. I've got two questions in relation to trauma-informed training for key players in the courts. So my first question is probably for Laura Buchan, and it relates to defence agents. Now, my understanding is that whilst there is trauma-informed training available from organisations such as the Law Society, no doubt lots of other organisations as well, it's not mandatory. It's a voluntary course that's available as an option for continuous professional development. Do you think it would be helpful if there was compulsory mandatory training for defence agents that appear in the criminal courts? And my second question is probably more to David Fraser and relates to the judges, so whether that's sheriffs, judges in the High Courts. And what would you say is the quality of trauma-informed training that's available to judges, whatever judge that is, whichever criminal court that is? And do you think there is a requirement to significantly enhance that? Would it be fair to say that probably more judges have an understanding of trauma, a better understanding of trauma-informed practice than others? And how do we, if you like, improve their overall standard, because they must be, if you like, the gatekeeper in the courts? They're in charge of the court. They're the only people really that are in a position to insist on how courts are conducted. So if I maybe ask Laura.
Thank you, Claire. I think it's very difficult for me to answer on behalf of my colleagues in bar associations, and I did see the evidence from the Law Society and EBA last week. What I can say that is for COPFS, the trauma-informed training is mandatory for all our staff because of the importance that we feel that for every single member of our staff, they see that training. How that impacts in terms of court, and the same will be said in relation...
We've got a short time. It really was a question about defence agents. You've explained in great detail what your organisation does, but the other side of it, obviously, is the defence agents. If you don't feel you can respond, or it's not politic you to respond...
I don't think it's politic for me to respond. I suppose my second point was that ensuring our staff have training, it ensures that when in court, if there is what we feel an inappropriate line of questioning, or... anyone within that court, as an officer of the court, our staff are suitably skilled with the training to know when they should interject and when they should seek assistance from the court to ensure that anything that is not trauma-informed is being halted.
Thank you.
Maybe just pick up on that. The original vision that Lady Dorian had was that everyone within that courtroom would be trauma-informed, and that would include the defence agents. I know that what we're currently talking about here is expanded beyond the Specialist Sexual Offences Court, but that was the original vision.
We're not just talking about...
I understand that,
we're talking about all criminal cases. Yeah. So do you think... Could you maybe look at it in the context of all criminal cases?
I can give
your extensive experience.
This is a personal view. My view is that I agreed with that. I was very much part of that. Why would you actually trauma-inform some part of the system, but not all the part of the system? The question whether that should be in legislation for ourselves, including the defence, I think is not a question for me to answer. But there is most, my view is actually, why would you do it with someone, not all? Because the impact from one part of the system, for example, if we were to do it with...
So is uniform training now for all of those who sit in judgment in the criminal courts, right. Whether that's okay. Justice of the Peace Courts. So, just a brief answer in terms of...
I'll come, right. And I'm sorry, you might find this unhelpful, but I cannot speak for the judiciary.
Okay.
What
no,
I can
I
tell
that.
You
yeah.
is that I do know
but we
that...
we haven't got them asked, here, and you asked, maybe are the nearest person
okay.
who has an understanding.
I certainly have an understanding. to answer your question in terms of the quality of training, I think it's the best possible quality of training that we possibly could have. We have got Dr. Bruce, who has been highly involved working with our people in our Judicial Institute to develop that training and then to roll it out to the judiciary. I agree with you. It is the person who is sitting on the bench that has control of what happens within that courtroom, and it is absolutely essential that they have that empathy and understand what is happening and can detect. Again, this is my view. When a situation is developing, which they can anticipate, that this is creating trauma, and it's up to them of how that court is managed. Now, I've probably overstepped what I should have done there, but you asked for a view, so I've given you it.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can maybe just come in. We're just coming to the end of this session, and I'm going to come in with a question for David Fraser, and it's actually on part three of the bill, which we haven't touched on this morning, which is special measures in civil cases. I'm just interested in what, in your view, would be the resource implications of implementing part three. I know that you did set that out in your submission as it's currently drafted, but also in relation to the potential for part three to include more ambitious proposals, which some victims' organisations have indicated that they would like the Scottish Government to do.
Within the criminal side, on the one hand, you could say actually it's not a massive sea change if you're doing this in the criminal dimension to moving at civil dimension. We have a lot of staff that work in both areas. Once they're upskilled, absolutely. The issue in relation to the cost is we've got about 26 remote sites. We often have witnesses who link in from that. So it is really about just getting our technology in our civil courts up to the same level of technology we have in our criminal courts to allow us to have that uniform approach, irrespective of whether it's civil or criminal business.
Thank you. And in the context of potentially the proposals being a little bit more ambitious, is that feasible for one thing?
Sorry, Convener, you'll help.
So in terms of part three, the proposal around extending special measures to civil cases, obviously what you've just outlined is around, in particular, the implications for IT systems. Should the proposals be expanded from what they are at the moment within the bill, would that necessarily have any impact, is what I'm saying?
Right. My view on that is, providing we have got the technology upgraded in terms of these courts, then no, I think it's something that we could do. And you could argue, actually, why would you separate the different jurisdictions if you have got trauma in one sphere? Why would you not deal with it in any sphere?
Okay. And just to clarify, the organisations that I should have said that the organisations that have highlighted this are Scottish Women's Aid, Rape Crisis Scotland and Victim Support Scotland. I think that was when they were in previously giving evidence. So thank you for that response. Okay. And I've got one very final question, the shortest question today from Russell
question
Finlay.
Ever, I promise you. It's towards Mr Fraser. The SCTS submission warns that the possible costs of the bill could be substantially higher than stated in the financial memorandum, so much so that you've written to the Finance Committee. I wonder, first of all, whether that letter includes any projected likely cost and or whether the letter could be shared with this committee.
Can I give you a very short answer and say I'll come back to you on that one?
OK, that's great. Thank you.
I don't have the details of that particular letter, but I will take that question away and I will
maybe the clerks can tell us the answer to that. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. That's been a very comprehensive session. Thank you to all our panel members for your time this morning. And we'll just have a short suspension to allow a changeover of panel members. Thank you. Okay, thank you, members. Our next item of business is to continue our pre-budget scrutiny of the Scottish Government's 2024-25 budget. And I'm pleased to welcome to our meeting this morning Cadden McCluskey, Chief Executive of Community Justice Scotland, Chris McCulley and Bill Fitzpatrick, also of Community Justice Scotland. So a warm welcome to you all, and thank you for your comprehensive written submission. So we have around about 45 minutes or so for this session, and given just the range of questions and responses we had this morning, and time is slightly caught up with us, so I wonder if I can just propose to members that we will drop items 3 and 4 from our agenda, which is just our private discussions following our public session. Are members content with that? Thank you. Okay, so I wonder if I can just open up questioning as usual with a very general question. I'll come to Cadden first of all and then bring in Bill and Chris. So I wonder if you can just outline for us the main challenges for spending in relation to either your own budget or the sums allocated for community justice more generally.
Most of this will be self-evident to the committee members. You will have heard it almost from every other person who's presenting evidence. The community justice, and we are a broad, you know, we are a broad church. We are still experiencing huge difficulties after the pandemic. You know, you will obviously be aware of the challenges around remand, around the amount of people who are getting released into the community, the high costs that are occurring just now. We rely hugely on third sector. They are often the lowest paid. They work on year-to-year funding. Every January, people will be getting notice that they may lose their jobs, and yet we rely on them absolutely, essentially, for the delivery of this. They are the unsung heroes in lots of the work that we do around community, every community in Scotland, and they're having real terms cuts in their funding. Members will be aware of the recent work, you know, media around the 218 service. We only have 68 bail accommodation places in the community for the whole of Scotland. It is vastly challenging, and you would expect me to say that, but community justice and the services that we provide are some of the solutions to what we're experiencing right now in the prison service, around the custodial sentences that women get, and it can and has achieved a great deal with very limited resources, but we are going to have to fund it differently.
Thanks very much. I don't know if either Chris or Bill, do you want to just come in on any of that?
Yeah, just on a specific issue, talking about the CJS budget, which is currently sitting about the core budget, a shade under 3.4 million, which funds our activities. In the current environment, we are being encouraged and, in fact, directed towards realising efficiency. Our total budget is actually just a shade over 4 million, and that's because we carry on activities, Caledonian System, Central Team and Restorative Justice, which are funded from other ends or other parts of the Scottish Government. It's really difficult to drive efficiencies across an organisation when your budget sits in three separate parts, and recently it was more than that. So we think a measure that would assist us driving those cashable efficiencies through the budget would be to consolidate that budget and make it simpler, that efficiency could be driven across the line. And that would be helpful, because the bits of activity that our organisation take care of is where maximum demand is being applied at the moment within the sector. So training being one of the areas of that, where the demand is almost endless, and our ability to meet that demand and fully satisfy the sector requirements is proven increasingly difficult. Our efficiency measures we've committed to have been to collaborate further with other organisations, and we're talking to other sector partners, including RMA. We have Scottish Government involved in those conversations and the child services organisations to see if we can establish what the actual quantum for the training resources amongst the organisations and across organisations. But it's difficult for us to fully contribute to that effort to do what the government are asking us to do without having full control and full sight of the total budget we have available. So it's quite a minor thing, but I think a very important thing for us to play our part in driving efficiency through the system, particularly the bit of the system that we are responsible for.
Yeah. Thank you for that. Chris McCulley, is there anything you want to just add into that?
Yeah, certainly. I think in line with Bill's comments, the opportunities, I suppose, that could be provided through additional resource for Community Justice Scotland would support us to do a range of activities. I think that through those efficiencies or through being at so close to capacity, we have not been able to progress over recent years. So things around about changing the diversity of that training offer, broadening the number of training outputs in terms of different courses that were offered. So things like, for example, training for working with people who have sexual offences convictions. Obviously, that's an area of considerable growth in terms of court business and sentences. So that's an increasingly prevalent area that the training is required for. So new products, work like that, I think would be beneficial. But also, I think some of the things that we've highlighted in our submission in terms of where justice could be done better in terms of different interventions, disposals, ways of working in the justice system, additional funding to support some of those sort of piloting approaches, innovation, development work that requires, I think could be very beneficial as well.
Thank you for that. And just by way of follow-up to your comments, in your submission, you set out the impact of reduced resources, in particular due to the sort of increase in some of the statutory functions that you have. So, for example, expansion of arrest referral services, increases in the number of diversion from prosecution cases, and there's a number of other areas. So if that is the case, and I'm sure there's no reason that won't happen, you know, that's at sort of one end of the system, if you like. What are your concerns around the impact that will have on the preventative work that we want to see develop, and you know, it's well set out in the vision for justice, and some of that really contemporary effective work? What are your concerns about how that may well be impacted that we need to think about?
So my concern is that we will retreat into, you know, the statutory functions. So what we are required to do statutorily, and not the other preventative aspects. So things like arrest referral, I mean, there are some spectacular work going on. I mean, we talked about some of the work around diversion from prosecution, some of the expansion of electronic monitoring. We've got obviously the bail and release from custody bill coming ahead, which will put additional resources, and none of it is low cost and no cost options. The third sector, again, they are, you know, obviously we've got some of the work around homelessness. We have around 55% of people released from prison unplanned from remand at the moment. They are released often with no place to stay, without a liberation grant, without even, you know, some of the medication that they may require. They land in our homelessness services, you know, and it's almost a cliff edge. They're almost urgent cases. And the capacity of organisations to be able to deal with that as an emergency is severely restricted. So it is, I mean, it's a whole area that's under real pressure right now.
OK, I'm just going to open it up to members, and I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay to kick off.
Thanks very much. Thank you. The submission is extremely helpful and detailed. No, it really is. And I think the most striking and perhaps shocking statistic in it is the fact relating to funding of criminal justice social work, with the government appear to have decided to not increase the budget by a single penny for three consecutive years, which, of course, means a substantial real terms cut. Now, the money dictates everything that you might want to do, as you've already told us. And we've got the new edition of the bail bill coming into force quite soon. So given the Scottish Government does place a great deal of emphasis on greater use of community disposals and moving away from imprisonment and so on, that seems to be at odds with that statistic. And I just wonder whether you're confident that that will change and what you can do to persuade the government to effectively put their money where their mouth is.
So that is a big question. So you're right. If it matters to us, it's going to need to matter when the budgets are set. We are in a way not visible. You can't see and feel and touch us like a prison service. And, you know, and I think sometimes we lose out by this because we're quite hidden. Sometimes it's really long-term work. I mean, if you talk about things like Caledonian, which is delivered by Justice Social Work, really complicated, really skilled services. And each of the people who are on it, it takes 2 years to get them through the programme. They need to be funded to do that and funded so that they've not over, you know, they've not got other cases that are coming on and you're bringing them to their knees because they are a really stressed service, as are our third sector services. There's never going to be enough money to deliver this, you know, and I understand that I'm a realist. But we need to look at it. I mean, I think it's something like, in fact, I was just looking at it earlier on. It's 2.5% of the overall budget, justice budget, goes to social work and 1.47 goes to community justice. It is minuscule on the overall scheme of things. And we are on a burning platform at present in relation to the prison service and in terms of the numbers of people who get into prison. If we want something different, we will need to fund it.
Going back to the Caledonian system, I noticed that 19 of the 32 local authorities are able to provide this training. 13 are not, purely because of money. What difference would it make if all local authorities could do this?
Well, so I slightly love Caledonian service, so I could go on for the rest hour about this. It is the only accredited programme in Scotland. So it goes through what's called SAPOR, which accredits it. It's really detailed. But you need skilled women's workers, you need skilled children's workers, because obviously domestic abuse affects, you know, affects whole families and indeed communities. And you need extra social workers to be able to do it. Now, it's £4.1 million a year that comes from Scottish Government to fund Caledonian. It's in 19 local authorities. Other local authorities have bought in their own, you know, their own programmes. 6 local authorities have nothing. That's not to say that they don't do anything with those who are convicted of domestic abuse, but they don't have any full-time programmes nor get anything extra. And some of those local authorities are actually areas where domestic abuse is incredibly prevalent, where there's big challenges.
The 6 local authorities, is it a matter of public record who they are? Are they large populations, for example, or...?
They are. Some of them are large. Would you like me to read them out? Hang on.
If you've got them, yeah.
Argyll and Bute. I'm going to mispronounce this. Éilean Sar. Is that how you say it? East Renfrewshire, Inverclyde and Orkney.
Right, OK. Thank you. That's great.
So we did also have Western Bartonshire, but Western Bartonshire we are funding right now. Have I pronounced that wrongly? I do apologise. Western Bartonshire, but we Western Bartonshire are actually funding it themselves and we are in the process of training them right now.
Team, so thank you. Yeah.
Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, Convener. And it is just a follow-up from where Russell Finlay was asking there, because in the submissions that we've had from Causeland Social Work, they have expressed concern that there's no increase in funding. And they've talked about there would have to be an increased focus on core functions at the expense of more targeted preventative services. What is it that... What's your understanding that's meant by that?
So it would just be what they need to deliver. So lots, I mean, you will understand that lots of the functions that social work, they go beyond what is statutory, that is, you know, the CPOs, the supervision, etc. They do a huge amount of other services, like some of the bail support services. They extend, you know, into some of the diversionary work. But when it comes to priority, they're going to focus on CPOs and what is statutory. So bail supervision, which is obviously is provided by almost every local authority in the country. But these are hugely resource intensive. And what Justice Social Work, and I can't speak solely for them because I'm really for the broader community justice, we have increasingly complex people. 41,000 people who came into police custody last year had designated mental health issues. And that is translating into the groups that we're looking at. And so many of the people who we've got in there require hugely additional services. And, you know, and Justice Social Work are not going to be able to do that.
The reason why I asked about that question, the reason why I asked that question was because I'm not sure. It's quite a stark statement. When I seen it myself, I thought, you know, and obviously it's a cry for help to the committee in some respects, but I'm not really sure how it would pan out, if that makes sense. And I'm looking at my own experience here and saying, well, you know, part of the work would still carry on. People wouldn't just, you know, hang up the phone or not go out and do that. So would it have been better if the submission, and I know it's not for you fully to answer, I do understand that, and it's really just for a view on it, would it have been better if the submission was more looking at, you know, where actually, how much extra money could we do with, and where would we put it in order to support all these functions? Do you understand where I'm coming from?
Yeah.
In terms of, I think what it means in practice, I think, is that we already see things like statutory through care, voluntary through care that's provided by Justice Social Work Services. We've seen that decreasing over recent years to the point where it's now sort of, I think the most recent figures was 1,800 cases a year, down from maximum. Now, in terms of the statutory functions we're referring to in that context, I think that's something where the Social Work Act gives Justice Social Work a general duty to provide advice and assistance, but there is no statutory definition of what through care is. So it's in the space for things like that and things like diversion and supervised bail where there's not a strict statutory definition of what their duties are in relation to that. I think that you start to see the biggest impact in a reduction on those if other workloads and resources, if workloads increase and resources don't increase commensurately, because we can see already those things that are resource intensive, that are good things to have, that make a real positive effect, they can't be prioritised anymore. And we also see it passed on to the voluntary sector. So in COSLA and Social Work Scotland's submission, and as you'll see from the Criminal Justice Voluntary Sector Forum, the justice social work budgets are frequently used, the Section 27 money they receive, to fund the voluntary sector, and that's externally commissioned services across a range of different areas. But those services are now having to be cut consistently because they have to prioritise in-house delivery because of those statutory responsibilities. So I think those effects are not just sort of concerns for the future, but they're things that are happening now. And in terms of justice social work having to reduce the focus of their work, we're seeing that through obviously the submission from COSLA and Social Work Scotland, but recent research from Social Work Scotland setting the bar report and various follow-up ones have shown that people are social workers are having to focus on those core functions away from some of the more in-depth rehabilitative person-centred work that they might be doing that would actually, in their opinion, might make more of a difference to people's lives. And in terms of the COSLA and Social Work Scotland position, I can't comment on what they should have written, but I think it's certainly their experience and what they're saying about the difficulties in delivering services in the current financial environment are backed up by what we're hearing from local community justice partnerships in areas that is a challenging environment to deliver justice services, and partly and because justice is the final funnel. If you look at research like the Hard Edges Scotland report, it's the bit that all the other failures and all the different systems in health, in housing, in employability, all those things bring people into the justice system. So the people we are working with in terms of community justice face a whole range of issues that are compounded and multiplied, and then so there are people that need frequently a lot of help, a lot of support, and having a lack of resources to allow you to do that in a flexible and long-term way, and instead have to focus on delivering an order or delivering certain hours or delivering court reports, I think is bound to have an impact.
John Swinney.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I tend to steer clear of an awful lot of budget discussion for obvious reasons of history, but I'm struck by two things about the submission and what you've said. First thing is that obviously your area of the pie is very small. Even without the share of the justice pie is very small. But what you are doing has the potential to avoid much greater cost. The previous panel that we're just in, Sue Brooks, who was here from the Scottish Prison Service, was making the point that the Scottish Prison Service ultimately is the destination for all failure. But it's an expensive destination for all failure, and you offer a much cheaper alternative to that failure. So that's my first observation. My second is money is incredibly tight across everywhere. There's nowhere in the Scottish public finances that is doing fine. Everywhere is under pressure. So that takes me to the challenge for reform. So where is the are the conversations taking place with your other justice in the justice family? Because, you know, yes, I accept you've got a very small part of the pie, but there's others that have got big resources. They would also say they're under pressure. So is there a reform conversation going on within the justice family about shifting the balance in favour of preventative, forgive my crudeness, but lower cost interventions? And conversations with the wider public sector, because you just made the point a moment ago that you know, a large proportion of the prison population has got mental health challenges. So where is the health service in amongst all of this? Are the conversations, given how tough things are for everybody across the public sector, are the conversations happening that would enable some of that tilting of the balance, which might end up with, I would contend, would end up with better outcomes being achieved for everybody, are they actually happening?
Oh, you don't have to persuade me about the, you know, the importance of prevention. I absolutely agree with you. Are the conversations happening? Yes, they are. Has there been enough space for them to translate into action plans? No, I don't think there are. I think people are so busy just now. The capacity for people to get that space and thinking time to think, well, what else could this look like? We put in a submission around the human and economic costing. You're right, we only get a very small slice of the pie. And, you know, but the people that we are supporting touch the NHS, touch, you know, touch family support, they touch everything. Education is, it's the whole gamut of the sort of the public services that are out there. We did put in that we would really like to do some human and economic costing. I know that was done within the promise. That less than 1% of young people go into care, and yet they are 30 to 40% of the prison population, is a statistic that we should not be proud of. I mean, it's, you know, and that really tells you that actually we need to be thinking about more prevention. How do we stop people getting into the system, getting people into sustainable jobs, paying tax, looking after their families, family support? And there is much more that we could be doing around that.
When you see the conversations are happening, people don't have the thinking space to think differently. I have to say I'm not persuaded by that argument. I know people will always be busy. What I'm trying to probe at is whether there's actually serious, heavy thinking going on about changing the model. But and this is not just about yourselves, because I'm a huge admirer of what you do and the emphasis and the focus on prevention. But I accept that without tilting the balance more in favour of prevention, you'll not get more prevention. And I'm also not going to sit here and say there's a pot of money somewhere else, because I know full well there ain't. So I'm interested in how that focused, hard discussion can happen to realign budgets and approaches to shift the focus of our system away from what in a lot of the cases we are doing of picking up the pieces rather than to avoiding the you know, the person being broken in the first place.
This is my personal view. We need a long-term policy and plan, not something that is delivered within 4 years, because that doesn't work. It's not worked anywhere, really, even internationally. You need a long-term plan about how we're going to reduce the prison population and shift money into prevention. And we don't have that yet. I don't have a clear idea about what the direction of travel is, how many people is too many people in our prison service, what is it we want for the people who are entering the justice system, and what that looks like for Scotland. I think with a clearer long-term plan, and Christie started this off, you know, so many years ago, and we've had iterative reports that have told us about the direction of travel, you know, from James Heckman, who came here, who was a Nobel laureate economist, who said that every pound that you invest early years, you will have to invest around £15 to £16 to get a different outcome. Now, he talked about dollars and not pounds, but I'm showing that sort of equivocation. We have not managed to do that in any meaningful way that's going to stop people coming into the system. Although, I would say, on a positive note, I think if you look around what has happened in youth justice and the numbers of people in the system just now, that is a huge, you know, I mean, it's an amazing, you know, transformation in the system. I mean, in 2009, we had 921 16 and 17-year-olds in the prison system. In 1920, we had 149, and this year it's even lower. That will eventually translate through the system, you know, as we prevent more people coming in. But there is much more that we need to do, and we need a coherent long-term plan.
But
for, you know, this.
Without, I'll stop speaking after this because I'm going to end up sounding very defensive here. I don't think that's been for the lack of policy focus from or attention from ministers. And I've been one of them, so I'm sounding super defensive here. And I think what gives me hope is the experience you've recounted there about youth justice, which I think is an incredible transformation of performance, and long, long overdue. But I'm interested in why we've not been able to get the necessary focus on shifting that balance across the wider public sector. Is it because there are too many players involved? Is it because we're too stuck in the groove of what we've done?
All of the above, yeah. Perhaps, Mr. Swinney.
I think, you know, I'll just give you my perspective on it. Your question implied, was there any serious discussion about effectively rewiring the justice budget? Well, there's not. That's not happening in any substantial sense. So the police get funded, they've got $1.4 billion, just over. Any serious discussion? We are in Justice Committee with the police, Justice Board with the police, and the other big. Any indication that they would be willing to surrender some of that over to community justice? No. If I was the Chief Constable, I wouldn't be doing it either. But.
Well, you see, look, now, let me just stop you there, Mr. Fitzpatrick, because I think that's a really interesting observation. So you're sitting on a justice board with all these players and there is no serious discussion of that point, which makes my point that somewhere there has to be an impetus and a priority to realise that we, you know, the model has to change. And ultimately, now I appreciate there'll be others that will say, you know, the police budget cannot possibly ever be less than this plus. And, you know, this committee hears those representations. But ultimately, there has to be some degree of conversation if we're not going to, shift that balance.
I agree with you, Mr. Swinney, not only by your direct question, by the implications that flow from it. So there has to be a discussion at some point about what we want the justice budget to do. And if we place as much faith as we do in things like the Vision for Justice for Scotland, which was published last year, the National Strategy for Community Justice, if an uninformed reader of those things would think, oh my goodness, the government are putting full strength behind community justice, and then you look at the budget, the whole community justice, not the bit we control, the whole community justice element of the Justice and Veterans budget is 4%. 96% of it's spent on preventing crime and patrolling the streets, prosecuting people and locking them up in jail. And I think the famous Joe Biden once said, you show me your budget and I'll tell you what your values are. And that's where we are at the moment. So I don't say this with any animus towards it. I was a police for 30 years. I was a police officer, senior police officer. And I know the pressures are under. But my sense in the justice sector and across, you've alluded to it yourself, everybody, is it, whether they are or not, is in a position they're holding the line. It's the reason why we get a retreat to statutory duties. That holds the line. I have to do that. So that's what I'm going to prioritise and do. We're not moving forward on it. And I would say, Karen might disagree with me, she'll probably give me a row after this, but the serious discussions that you thought were happening or thought might be happening are not.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Katie Clark.
Yes, thank you. My questions were going to be very similar to John Swinney's, so I will take that forward. And it is about this disconnect between stated policy and reality on the ground. Now, if we look at the budgets, according to Spice, the community justice budget is flat in real terms. You'll know this committee spent a considerable amount of the last year looking at the bail legislation that's coming through. And it's quite clear that from Angela Constance that the long-term strategy of the Scottish Government is to shift towards more community justice disposals as an attempt to try and reduce prison numbers, or even just to keep prison numbers where they are, because the direction of travel, as we know, is up. So surely the people that drive change are the politicians. It's the government. Who else can possibly drive change if it's not the politicians that are put there to do it? Who else in the system is in a position to do that? And what discussions have you had as an organisation with ministers about what they expect from you if the money that the sector is getting isn't increasing? Are you being asked to do more? Is it being made explicit to you? Because surely the courts will only dispose using community justice disposals if they're actually there. Isn't that the major factor that's determining the fact that our prison numbers are continuing to go up and the sector's actually shrinking rather than expanding, from what you're saying? Is that fair?
It is fair. So, Ms Clark, the Sentencing Commission last year put out a paragraph, and it said, one of the greatest challenges to judicial confidence in community disposals concerns the limitations of resources to support their management and delivery. A more consistent approach to the development and funding of these disposals to support a more consistent provision, robust management and successful completion would enhance judicial confidence and would be expected to support an increase in the use of community-based disposals. I have been involved in judicial training over the last number of weeks. I must have spoken to around 100 sheriffs. Mm-hmm. And what they say to me is, I'll ask them, because we still have about 5,100 short-term sentences. And I know people, you know, talk about, you know, really difficult people. And I say to sheriffs, why are you still using them? And their general, and I can't speak for them, but I'll paraphrase. So 20% won't comply with community sentences. And we all know who they are. I mean, I've dealt with them when I was in the police and violence reduction unit. But 80% can't comply. They're the guys that, you know, you tell them they've got to be 2 o'clock at, you know, at drug services, and then they've got to be at homelessness, and then they've got to be here. They don't have a diary. You know, they're chaotic, and we need something different. So, I mean, in the submission, we've said we need to look at other types of community sentences because things have changed. People are more complicated. We need to think about how we manage them in communities. This is primarily about reducing victimisation.
So are you saying that sheriffs and others are not making community-based disposals because they don't think the offender will comply with them?
Or that they're not available.
They're not
available. I think
it's
that they're not available. It's not that they won't comply, because I think that in the majority of cases, we do get...
So you're saying the Scottish Government needs to put its money where its mouth is?
Well, we need to have consistent provision. I mean, and in fact, that is in the community justice plan that we're doing. That we need to have consistent provision across Scotland. So we mentioned Caledonia in there, only available in certain places. Mm-hmm. And it shouldn't be right that, for example, you might get a different sentence in Inverness and a different sentence in Eastern Bartonshire. Mm-hmm. There should be the same parity of services. Although what is there already is really, really very good. You know, 74% of people complete their orders.
Do you think if those alternatives were available in every part of the country, they would be used by the courts?
Yes, I think they would be used by the courts.
Thank you.
I think also underlying that question, I mean, it's easy, simply, really easy to sort of point the finger at government or nod your head or just say, but we have a role in that. We're an advisory body. We're meant to advise ministers. We're meant to contribute to the conversation. We need to be better at that. So, I mean, this submission here is one of the first times we've done a detailed analysis on this level. But we need to convert that, because part of our mission is to inform, not only advise ministers, is to inform the public. We need to make sure that this sort of information, the stuff that's compelling, actually is in the public discourse and the political discourse. So actually part of the problem is we've still got a way to go to be convincing round about that. Because as things stand, we know what decisions policymakers think are their priorities, and most of them may be right, but we need to be a better part of that conversation and more active at it.
John Swinney, no surprise. You'd
without
like to
risk
come back
of becoming of appearing, which is difficult as the spokesman for the government, I think that the point that's important here is about the political discourse, because it's not just all about the government. I'm not, colleagues know I'm not in any way personalising this, but there is a limitation on the amount of money available, and in that context, how do we try to reshape outcomes by the better use of money? And by doing the same, let's say that for simplicity's sake, it's 96-4. If we just keep on 96-4 forever, chances are we're going to get roughly the same outcomes, or perhaps, as Katie Clark has rightly said, worse outcomes, because the numbers incarcerated are rising exponentially. So the 96-4 might inevitably become 97-3. Or 98-2, because we're going to worse outcomes.
Mr. Swinney, can I also say around the prison service? I have worked in the prison service. My colleagues in the prison service work incredibly hard. There are still a need for prison places in Scotland.
Of course.
Much fewer, but the prison staff and the people who work there need the latitude and ability to be able to intervene with people, to get them on programmes, and to work to try and rehabilitate them. They can't do that if there's 8,000. And so we have to be the solution for the problems in Scotland. We must be the solutions. And so we're going to have some very hard conversations, I think, with everybody, including members of the committee, around what it is we want and how we're going to pay for it in the future.
And I think the other thing about this is we obviously are part of the community justice sector. We're the only national body for community justice. We don't have blind authority. But if I was the government, I wouldn't give us a penny more till we justified why you would spend that penny in community justice, why it would deliver the benefits you think it's going to deliver. We need to be much more convincing about what that change that needs to happen will deliver for Scotland. Will it make it a safer place? Will people rehabilitate? Will people stop reoffending? Why would that be good? Because in the absence of that convincing case, I'm going to keep on spending money in the police, keep on spending money in the courts, and keep on spending money in the prison service, because that I've no alternative.
Thank you. I think Sharon Dowie is next, followed by Rona Mackay. Sharon.
Yep, thank you. I think Bill's actually just touched on my point there. I was going to come up on outcomes. So one of that, again, going back into John Swinney's last question, you'd mentioned figures for youth justice and the lower number of youths in custody. But one of the things that I'm certainly getting in my inbox is a lot more complaints about the rise in antisocial behaviour and crime on the streets. And it seems to be that police are saying that their hands are tied in action that can be taken. So what role would community justice have in there? And what action needs to be taken? And where is it we're failing in that respect? Because we're saying that we've got good measurements because we've got less youths in custody. But crime out in the street seems to be on the rise. So as far as outcomes go, but it's not a good outcome.
So if you look at the stats, crime is coming down. Crime is coming down.
But that's because it's not been reported. But, well,
listen, absolutely. I've got family that have been affected by online crime, and I don't think they probably reported it either. So we can, But generally, in terms of recorded crime, it is coming down. I don't have anything to do with antisocial behaviour on the streets. That would be a question for the Chief Constable. But in terms of for those who are bailed, the majority of people do not commit crime whilst they're on bail. But there are those who need supported whilst they're on bail. And the challenge for us right now, and in fact for the whole of the justice system, is the fact because court cases are taking much longer to be, to be arranged, etc. People are on bail for really substantial amounts of time. And of course, there is an increasing risk that they may then, reoffend or breach their bail conditions. And that is, that's just what we're dealing with right now. But in terms of delivering a change, only The reconviction rate for people who are on CPOs is 25%, generally. But for if you're in a short-term sentence, for a reconviction rate, if you're sentenced to under 3 months, is 61% reconviction. 3 to 6 months, 54%, and 6 months to a year, 41%. So it's not working. We have 10,500 people going to jail every year, and 8,600 come back within the year. We are much more effective at preventing reoffending than short-term sentences. I think if you enhance some of the work that was around in communities, I think we could drive that even lower. I don't think that's quite answered your question.
No, that's kind of good, but it's basically focusing the resources that you've got in the right areas.
Absolutely. And people need wraparound services. We deal with really complicated people, often who've committed, you know, numerous sort of low-level crimes, but they are complicated. They're often, you know, enslaved in substances. You know, we need to try and get them into, you know, substance misuse services, into recovery. That takes quite a long time. That takes a long time. It's very technical work.
Yeah. Okay, and I'd probably go back to Bill Fitzpatrick's point, Owen. I think some of the organisations need to give us more evidence on what the outcomes are going to be. Because
So data. So I trained as an intelligence analyst, so data is everything. When I've been in front of the committee before, they've said that they really lack some of the data around community justice. I would agree. Mm-hmm. I would have a data hub in my organisation in a heartbeat. I'd be trying to get the stats that tell you what's actually happening there, where improvement is happening, because you can't take my word, oh, yeah, things are getting better. I can give you some broad stats, but there's detail underneath that that I need to give to the committee and to the government and to the Scottish Government, and we don't have that right now because we've prioritised other data sources. And I heard the previous committee talking about some of the data that they need around for the Victims and Witnesses Bill, and I would say it's probably one of the biggest gaps that we have. If we want to look at some of the criminal issues around as a public health issue, the first part of that is surveillance. What is it you know about the issue, and how do we know whether we're getting better and not worse? And so we don't have that, Ms Downey.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I think just on the point of outcomes, I'm going to say that sort of sound flippant, and it's not meant to be flippant, it's real from experience. People are always complaining about Wains. They've always done it for the whole of history. Every generation of Wains has been a problem. They're running riot, they're uncontrollable, they're not like us. But there is a serious issue about that. I think the vast majority of that is not a criminal justice issue. It's about children feeling secure, children feeling supported, children being in the positive influence of education, children being in family or carer groups. It's about that. But it recurs all the time. When I was a divisional commander back a million years ago, the most letters I ever received, not about murders, not about rapes, not about anything, was Wains causing bother and gang fights. It wasn't to be ignored. I think the direction of youth justice in the country is the best example that we've got. Take children out of the criminal justice system, mainly, except in the extreme cases, which are very, very obvious, and treat them in the care system. Make sure they're supported and make sure that that's available for them. So we're tangentially involved in that. Youth justice issues isn't a particular specific responsibility we've got, but we're on the Youth Justice Board, where I'm represented on, have been for the last 5 years, and that rights approach to youth justice is the correct route, in my view, to go, and will help. But it's a typical wicked problem. Children will always present every day an issue.
OK, thank you. I've got a couple more members would like to come in, and then I think we'll have to pull the session to close. So Rona Mackay, then Pauline McNeill.
Thanks, Convener. I will be brief. I think this is a really, really interesting discussion we're having, a really interesting session, and what we're learning is if we keep doing the same thing, budget-wise, things are not going to get better. In fact, they'll get worse. And it goes back to the point, I think, that John Swinney made and that you more or less made the case for it as well, Mr Fitzpatrick, is about the sector getting together to discuss how we can do things differently. Because, you know, if we cut the Scottish prison budget in the next budget, there'd be an outrage because that preparatory work has not been done. So my question to you is, do you think it's possible for yourselves and government to effect change in the way that we need to do it? Do you think it's possible? But as you say, Mr. Fitzpatrick, quite rightly, you know, it hasn't happened and people are protecting their own areas. So That needs to change so that, I mean, I guess being a bit simplistic about it, if we're putting more less people in prison, which we aim to do, that there shouldn't be that need for such a huge budget. That might be simplistic, and that money could be, you know, put into community justice. Yeah. But those are things that would need to be. I mean, I'm certainly no economist, so those are things that would need to be. But until we start having the conversation about change, nothing's going to happen. Am I right?
You're absolutely right. And it's not just a simple, you know, taking money from the prison service and putting it in community justice. No, yeah. I absolutely. Yeah. Because obviously health and homelessness, etc., you know, is all impacted. So it's a broader government cake. We don't actually have that many people. I know we've got a lot of people in prison right now. There are not that many people in community justice. So if you're talking about 15 or 20,000, you can almost imagine them. You know, you can start to think, who are high need, who need extra services, who are the ones who, you know, maybe come in once but won't come back in. And I actually think that we could start to cost that out. And I think we need to look at costing outcomes, how much it's going to cost us to deliver. And then you need to look at us a bit like a sort of start-up company. Mm. We need start-up money to be able to affect that change. And I think absolutely we can do it. I'm incredibly optimistic about it. I bang on about preventative services, about preventing people to come in, you know, all the time. I just think we need to set the direction of travel, and that is about long-term change, and politicians will need to do that. I can't make up the strategy or the policy. We need to, you know, set the direction of travel and then go forward relentlessly to try and achieve that.
And it has been done in other countries. I think it is possible. I mean, if you look at Finland and you look at a lot of other Scandinavian countries, Belgium, Netherlands, they decided in the 60s and 70s to have a fundamental shift in how they approach justice, much more focus on community interventions and keeping people out of prison and supporting their reintegration. And they did it. And I think we can do it as well through that kind of discussions. And I think in some senses, the discussion around different justice partners' budgets being cut, I think, is not necessarily the right one, because part of this is about how the resources that are deployed to police, prison service, courts, Crown Office are used differently. And I think there are levers for that and how we shift that in terms of, think the Community Justice Scotland Act puts a duty of collaboration on the part of those national partners to be engaged in community justice and to be thinking about how they can be doing it differently. But what we have is a very complex system with lots of different levers for change and lots of different bits that interact with one another that can produce all kinds of different outcomes. So I think the evidence on how you shift a system like that is that you first agree a clear direction of travel, you get a sense of shared values across those partners, and you try and drive it. And I think that is something that I think is happening to a degree. There are discussions, there's clear ideas through the Justice Vision and through the National Strategy for Community Justice, but how that translates into practice, I think, is the big gap. It's that implementation that's the challenge. And so I think additional money will help that if you can target it at specific things, but it's much more about how we use the resources we have to do the things we know that make the difference.
And my colleagues in Policeline, I am going to give a shout out to Police Scotland here. Have been hugely thoughtful around arrest, you know, diversion, about trying to get people in the custody cells to try and support people when they're bringing them into custody. I always used to say to my policing colleagues that the most important Peelian principle is, I think it's number 8, which is the absence of crime and disorder is a litmus test of great policing. And that is fundamentally moving into that preventative space. I know that we always focus on detection and how quickly we can get people to court, but it is about prevention, and we seem to have slightly forgotten that, you know, as things have become more challenging. But I do think it is completely possible.
I think the whole thing, excuse me, just to say, there is a cost to change, but there's also a time lag for effect to take place, and there needs to be patience about that. The thing that we need to prevent, we as an organisation, not you guys, but it's not a competitive sport. We don't have to be first across the line and people lose. I still feel we probably got the best police force in the world. We've probably got the best prison service in the world. We've probably got the best prosecution service in the world. If not the best, they'll be in the top echelon. That's a hard place to be in and say, we need more money to do what we're doing, and we shouldn't cut those budgets, because Those are excellent services. What we need to do is make space for something else to be happening, and we need to be patient enough to let it take the effects we think it's going to produce.
OK, thank you. And very finally, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. So it struck me that if we're being honest, successive governments and successive parliaments have tried to get the shift into community justice. So that's my view of it. We don't have time for you to get to answer my question. I wonder if you could follow up with the committee. And the first is, and I think it would be helpful for a report, given the very good evidence you've given, is one, what are the numbers exactly that you're dealing with? Because I don't think we've got any sense of that. And secondly, so to wrap it up, if you like, what I'm hearing is if you had even a quarter of £1 million more, half £1 million more, you could do something with that. And to quote Bill Fitzpatrick, you know, don't give me a penny more until you can justify it. I agree with that, because that is public confidence and judiciary confidence are essential to move it forward. So I just wondered maybe you could follow up with the committee on the numbers and also give us some indication with it. If you did have additional budget, can you hit the ground running with the types of things that would give public confidence and judiciary confidence that instead of sentencing people to prison, you can sentence them to community services?
Yeah, I'm happy to sort of... I've got lots of numbers here. We could be here for the next hour if I started to go through them all around what that looks like. And yes, I do. I don't think it's just quarter of a million. I mean, when you're talking about services right the way over Scotland, it's a bit more significant than that, I have to say. I mean, we obviously, at the moment, we are commissioning through care in Scotland. The budget has been about 3.8 million for the last 5 years. And yet we have many more people coming through and we have to support them. If we adjust that for inflation, you could probably say that's around £5 million. And we've not adjusted it for inflation, so we're actually trying to do more with less. So there are whole areas of that justice journey where community justice services are involved that we need to look at in funding. And that's part of the evidence submission when we're talking about some of the economic costing and where we should perhaps put our money for greater, you know, for greater effect. But we'll get back to you on the numbers.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. OK, I am going to have to bring the session to a close. I'm sure we could have spent at least another hour on this. So thank you very much to our panel members for your time this morning. At our next meeting, next week on the 8th of November, we'll continue our pre-budget scrutiny when we hear from the Scottish Prison Service and then the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs. So that concludes our meeting, and I close this meeting. Thank you.